Radio Network.
That is right, Andrew. It is the Midnight Ocean Radio Show and Podcast. I am your host, Jeff Norton. For those that are joining us on YouTube, having a little fun there with our screen. For those that are not joining us on YouTube, you're missing half the show. Half the show is some of the quirky stuff we do on the live feeds here on YouTube. Man, do we have a show in store for you. We always have great shows in store for you, but this one's going to be a good one. It's a great way to end the week and to begin the weekend. We have a very special guest joining us all the way from L.A., Rick McCallum. Now, Rick is known for his stunt work and also some other things, but tonight we're going to talk about his group, Hollywood Ghost Hunters. So that'll be coming up here in a few. Let's take care of a little bit of housekeeping. First, I'd like to say thank you for joining us tonight. I appreciate it very much. If you are watching us on YouTube for the very first time, make sure you hit that subscribe button. That means a lot to us. If you are listening to us on Spreaker, thank you. Make sure you also hit that follow button. That is important as well. But most importantly, if you have friends or family, people that you know, people on social media that you think would enjoy our type of show, especially late night, it's something to kick back to, relax, put on as you're going to sleep. We will try not to keep you up all night, but I can't guarantee that. But let your friends and family know about us. We would appreciate that. We are growing by leaps and bounds. I will tell you, our listenership is just incredibly, incredibly growing. Can I put that together? I hear my old English teacher say that. Well, that was a muff. But it's all right. It's Friday and we're live here. So let's lay out some ground rules. The only two chat rooms that I listen to or that I watch during the show is YouTube chat and also the one on Spreaker. So if you want to chat me a message or ask the guest a message, feel free to hit that chat button. I just noticed YouTube for some reason is not live. Wow. So everybody missed that, the comical stuff. It's all right. There it goes. Finally decided to catch up with the rest of the world and stuff. So, but like I said earlier, tonight's going to be a fun show. We're going to probably make it lighthearted. We're going to be a little serious as we talk with our guest, Rick McCallum. Now, Rick is known in Hollywood as a stuntman. You've probably seen his work if you are into the horror movie genre. Now, I'll be honest with you. I'm not a big horror movie fan, slasher fan. I watch the classics, Freddy Krueger and, you know, Nightmare on Elm Street and the Alien series and everything. I just really didn't get into it. To be honest with you, I think I was afraid. I really was. But that's not what we're going to talk to Rick about tonight. Well, we probably will. I'm sure we'll delve into that world as well. But we're going to talk to him about his association with Hollywood Ghost Hunters. So without further haste, let me give you the introduction here. So Rick McCallum has been a stuntman and stunt coordinator for over 25 years. He has played Darkwolf in the movie of the same name, as well as the monster in Deep Star 6. Rick has been a stunt double for Chris Noth, Greg Evigan, Donald Baldwin, Patrick Woodburton, and Oliver Platt, Barry Bostwick, and many others. Rick and Kane Hodder, you might know that name, you might not, but we'll explain it to you. You'll know the character that he played, are the founders of Hollywood Ghost Hunters. And without further ado, our very special guest, Mr. Rick, how are you, sir?
I am fine. No other ado. That's it. I only got that little piece of ado.
You can get A, man. You Hollywood types, you always want more. you always want. What does it do, anyways? What is that? You know, we use these words like haste. I know haste. I gotta look that up. Ado, and figure out where that came from. Or am I just?
Well, ado means goodbye in French.
Oh, does it? I thought it was au revoir.
Yes. Well, ado.
Oh, okay. Well, who am I to argue? I don't know French. I can barely speak English. That's pretty obvious.
I have the same problems.
That's it. So how are you doing, my friend?
I am doing well.
Good, good, good. How's the how is LA out there? Are you guys still in turmoil?
No, not really.
Good.
It's actually pretty nice out right now.
Settled down.
No turmoil.
Yeah, we figured, you know, well, there's rumors that, California is talking about seceding from the union. So I just wanted to make sure. I was wanting to see if there was anything that we needed to report on.
I'm not exactly sure that it ever was in the union, to tell you the truth. If you live out here, you'd know what I mean.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It is a different world. I did spend some time, I'll tell you, in my computer days, and especially in data, doing data compression algorithms and stuff. And you know, when movies went from cellulose, you know, from film to digital, they're huge on digital compression technologies. And I spent some time out there, and I thought I was definitely in a foreign land.
Yeah, it's a different place. You know, I get to go, you know, we work on movies all around the country and sometimes different countries and things like that. And California's a world all unto itself.
It is. You know, what's really cool though, that I like about California, people don't have a problem speaking their mind though.
Well, I grew up in Chicago. I mean, I'm used to people speaking their mind.
Yeah.
Here, California, I'll give you a good idea. Everything here is built on the bigger, better deal.
Yeah, that's true.
You know, say I'm on a set and a girl likes me and I start talking to her, she'll go, oh, well, I want to go talk to the stunt coordinator. She'll talk to him. Then she'll want to talk to the director. And then she'll want to talk to the producer. And then she'll want to talk to the executive producer.
It's all the steppings.
It's the bigger, better deal. It's just the way it works.
Well, it was funny because last time I was in L.A., we were at a restaurant. I won't name the restaurant, but it was a fancy upscale kind of place. And, they were trying to, I guess, wine and dine me, which is cool. You know, when you think about it, you got these Hollywood execs, but we have the data compression that they needed to speed up the processing. A lot of people, you know, especially, you know, now with CGI and everything, literally to render a 30-second clip can take hours, you know, or used to take hours. And with all of the animation and stuff. So they were very interested in a lot of our data compression. So we're over there making a long story short. So I ordered my lunch and the waiter said, I think you really need to eat a salad. And I was, I was looking at him going, what? And he goes, yeah, you really, yeah, I think I would recommend a salad. I mean, the guy was just, and it was hilarious because we're sitting here and the people are embarrassed. And I just started laughing at him and had a good time with
him. Well, part of the new cruelty.
Yeah. Yeah, they tell you. I asked them, well, of course, I started messing with them because I asked them, I said, you know, where's the ashtray? I need an ashtray for my table. I got to smoke. And the guy kind of flipped off.
You know, if you smoke out here, people think you're the Antichrist.
I know. That's the first. I told them, I said, I'm
surprised they didn't fire hose you or something. Yeah.
Well, it was funny because I was sitting with some executives, some movie guys, and so they were sucking up to these guys. I actually think they were going to go get an ashtray. Because the clientele, I think he was actually going to go look for an ashtray for me. Cause I'm like, no, dude, I really need the ashtray. I can't, you know, I gotta have a smoke. And so he's looking at them.
Smoke now.
Well, yeah. He's looking at them and they're like, get the guy an ashtray. You know,
he's like, exactly. Oh. I actually was in Dallas one time with my dad and there was like 17 of us at a really nice restaurant. And I went to walk in and they said, you can't come in. You're not wearing a tie. Yeah. I said, then loan me a tie, because most nice places have ties. They said, we don't have one. And I said, well, there's 16 people, and they're eating dinner waiting for me, right? Yeah. And they said, you have to have a tie. And I said, okay. So I walked around the corner, and fortunately, I had a $100 bill in my pocket, and I folded it like a tie, and I put it in my shirt. And I walked up. I said, is this classy enough looking?
This is good enough for you. I know.
Yeah, and the guy goes, all right, go in. So anyway, I'm sitting there, and the waiter comes up, and he's going, yes, what would you like? I said, well, I just sat down. I need to look at the menu. And he goes, well, everybody's already ordered. I said, you're the waiter, right? And he goes, yeah. I said, then wait.
Yeah. It is in your term. Yeah, it is in your job description. It's in your title.
Yeah, it's right there. It says right there, the waiter.
The waiter. Wait.
Let me read the menu. Jeez.
No. I do it. No, I really love LA. I love it. And I love the vibe out there and stuff. It's just like I said, they've gotten to the point, a fat man like me, Yeah, it's like I'm an anomaly. It's like, look at the fat man.
Well, you know, out here, you know, L.A. is famous. We have things, you know, like emergency liposuction.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. So.
Yeah, it's like, oh, I'm sorry. Don't you make enough? You know, can you not have the surgery?
Yeah. Now, I used to go to one of the gyms, and you'd see all the people in their matching leggings and headbands, and, you know, all the guys had on, you know, the fanciest workout stuff. And really, none of them were working out. They were just posing at different stations, you know, for you to pay attention to them.
Yeah, yeah. And like I said, I highly recommend everybody go out to California. It's a whole different world. It's like, well, it's like being in a foreign country, except they do speak English for the most part.
Yeah, and the area is a great place to live. I mean, the weather's great. The beach is close. The people are relatively nice. Yeah. You know, none of them are Californians. They're all from somewhere else. I mean, there's like three people in the whole state that were born here. You know, everybody's from New York, Chicago, you know.
Yeah, yeah. Well,
Detroit, it's like, everybody's from somewhere else.
It's like my state, Florida. I mean, Florida,
that's true.
We got the one. It's hilarious because right after the New Year's, I'll tell people right after New Year's, they actually run. And I don't know if this is discriminatory in nature or not, but they actually run all the local attorneys here will run commercials. Well, now we have more drivers. We have 1.2 million more drivers on the road, and you really need to make sure your insurance is up to date. It's just like the snowbirds, and they're right though. I mean, it's crazy. We our population will increase by 1.2 million people right after New Year's is when they come in, and then they leave. You know, when the weather starts, when it hits 90, then everybody vacates, all of the snowbirds.
Well, you should just tell the snowbirds, when the last snowbird leaves Florida, please turn out the light.
Turn off the light. Well, the rest of us kind of like that. we're a little backwards. But yeah, electricity, the modern conveniences and stuff.
No, you a bunch of prima donnas. You want electricity and lights and stuff. Jeez.
Yeah. Well, I'd like to see, you don't have this thing, you know, it's easy for you to say, you don't have this thing called humidity. That we have. No, you have it, but
not a
but,
lot of humidity here.
Yeah, but yeah, you don't have, you know, it's one thing when it's 90 degrees, it's another thing when it's 90 degrees and 89% humidity.
I've lived in a few humid places, the kind where you like swim out to get the mail and you swim back because it's so humid.
Yeah, exactly. Well, and then, like I said, it was a huge shock for me coming from Chicago. You know, you're a fellow Chicagoan, and mm-hmm. you know, coming from Chicago to Florida, it was a shock. It's taken me a couple years, but we're adjusting, we're acclimating very well, and I would never change. I wish I would have moved down here 20 years sooner, because I'll tell you, there's something about stepping outside in 78 degrees in the middle of November, and
well, I wouldn't know anything about that living in California for the last 30 years.
Yeah, that's true. But you guys have, you know, one thing about California, though, is you have your lows at night, which are awesome.
Yeah, so, it gets cool. I mean, at night it gets down to like, you know, 53 or something.
Yeah.
Which is, if you happen to have your window open and you're sleeping under it, it gets a little chilly.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, enough about enough.
Well and good.
Yeah, that's it. Enough about that. Let's get into the meat. Let's get into it, my friend. And
I'm ready.
You know,
you go first.
It's your show. Why don't you do your show?
Yeah, you get to go. You go first.
You get to go. You go. And so you know, the biggest question is how do you go? All right. So I envision. Well, you're in great shape considering you are a stuntman. That's your profession, and everything. How do you go from being a big burly stuntman to being a guy who investigates ghosts? I mean, you would think that that's not in the, you know, they kind of don't go hand in hand. How did that happen?
Well, actually, I started out hunting ghosts before I became a big burly stuntman, actually. I started off in Chicago. There's a very famous place called Bachelor's Grove Cemetery. Mm-hmm. Which, when I was in college, my roommate and I used to go out, and most of the hauntings that people have heard about were probably us messing around out there. But that's where I got started. I actually got started ghost hunting before I ever got into the stunt business. Uh-huh.
All right. So then how do you go from ghost hunting to stunt? Was it just a necessity of having to pay the bills?
No. Always wanted to do it. Huh. Always. Matter of fact, when I was a kid, I was like three, my dad and mom took me to a John Wayne movie.
Sure.
And there was a scene where they run a stagecoach off a cliff.
Yes.
So we came back home, and we had a set of stairs inside our house. And my dad told me, he said, him and my mom were sitting on the couch, and all of a sudden they see me go roaring by in my little red pedal car. And he takes off after me, but didn't quite catch me. And he says, I just launched right off the top of the stairs and landed face first at the bottom of the stairs, for which I was rewarded with two black eyes. But he said, right then, I knew what you were going to do.
You got him.
I absolutely knew what you were going to do.
This is the cool. You know, that's funny you say that, because I was always like that kid, that rambunctious kid that would, you know, I was always, hey, you think we can ride our BMX bikes down the side of this hill or something like that? It's like, well, I don't know. Well, my brother is always like, well, how'd my brother do it, Jeff? It's like, Jeff, I'll give you a dollar. Sure. I used to do that, but I never thought about turning that into a career.
And see, so, you were a professional then.
I was a professional then. I only
trained. Yeah, you got a buck.
Yeah, I got paid. Yeah, I got paid for it. Don't tell the union that.
Yeah, that makes you a professional.
Don't tell the union. But no, it is insane. I mean, you know, stuntmen, a lot of people don't realize. I think that the stuntman and your profession, I mean, you are the guys that make the movie. I mean, most action movies, unless it's a love scene, but even then, you know, you still have probably have some stunt guys in there. Or body doubles in some cases, but if it's most movies are, you know, you guys are, it wouldn't be the same movie. Think about it, people. If you didn't have stuntmen out there, people risking their lives and everything doing the scenes and stuff. But, so what do you think about all the CGI that's going on? That's kind of replacing you guys.
Now that hurt.
Yeah.
As soon as you said CGI,
yeah.
Actually, you know, when CGI first started, stunt guys loved it. Because, you know, when we'd be doing people, you know, doing a thing called a ratchet, when you've got a harness on somebody and yanks them flying backwards like they've been shot
Sure. With
a shotgun, we'd put those on. But we always, it was so hard to try and, you know, hide the wiring.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden when they got, you know, blue screen, you know, they could just paint it out.
Yeah.
I mean, it wasn't a factor anymore. I mean, we all love that. And then now that they're actually making us, out of CGI, yeah. We're like, no, this is not good. You know,
yeah.
And I'm telling you, when they can make the people, I mean, look really realistic, and it's getting closer, mm-hmm. and make it be cheaper than hiring us, we're done.
Yeah. Well, exactly. I mean, I think I remember the old Sopranos when Sopranos' mother died. And the big whop or the big thing is that, you know, there was some scenes that she still had to be in for the get her out. And they did that CGI. A lot of people don't, if you guys want to see I think the real first human actor CGI interaction or whatever was in the Sopranos movie, where the mother, Tony Soprano's mother, she was all CGI there at the end. You know, it was all computer, you know, it's amazing now. And like you said, it is scary stuff. I mean, I saw videos the other day where a company, they can take videos of the president of the United States and they can make him say whatever they want him to say, or anybody. It doesn't have to be the president. It can be anybody. And it's a new technology come out of Texas. And all that.
Yeah, it's amazing some of the stuff they do nowadays.
Yeah, it's scary. It really is.
Well, but CGI does help, though, because, you know, like when you're having somebody, like take the Matrix, for example, when the guy's, all the cars are going around him, he's jumping up and jumping on the hoods and stuff like that. It's all CGI.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't think,
you know.
Well, I don't know. I mean, I've seen some pretty crazy stuff. You guys, hats off to you, though. I've seen you guys do some pretty crazy things.
Well, we did a thing in the Hamptons a couple of years ago, Kane and I. For those people who don't know, Kane Hodder is the guy who co-founded the Hollywood Ghost Hunters with me. And he's more famous as playing Jason in the Friday the 13th movies. And he also played Victor Crowley in all the Hatchet movies. He's actually famous for killing more people with his bare hands on screen than anybody in history. So, I mean, we've actually done a lot of that stuff. But we were doing a movie in the Hamptons. And if anybody's seen Footloose, where Laurie Singer stands between the two cars,
yeah.
Well, we had to recreate that Well, when she did it, she was going like 20, 25 miles an hour on a flat surface, straight.
Yeah.
We did it with a girl going 42 miles an hour around curves.
Wow.
So that was pretty interesting. And what a lot of people don't know about the movie business is they have to take multiple angles, multiple coverages. So we probably did it 20 times. And we never touched paint one time out of the whole thing.
That is, see, yeah. I mean, that's amazing. I mean, that's amazing. I mean, what kind of harness? Does she have any kind of harness on? Or what? I mean, what's the safety precautions that you do?
Absolutely. We had some special line that had like 4,000 pound, you know, braking capacity. And we had a harness on her, and we had three pick points off the car. So obviously you can't have her rigged into both cars because if something happens, you'll tear her in half. So we had her just on Kane's car, and I had a convertible Mustang, which was fun because it was, you know, early December in the Hamptons. Really cold. She could just stand there on the one, you know, the inside of his car, the door jamb, you know, up on the window, and just stand there with her other foot, you know, out into air. I mean, she wouldn't go anywhere. So all I had to do was come up and get the car close enough for her to stand on and then keep it close enough. And as we were going around corners and stuff like that to make sure we didn't, you know, do anything funny, knock her off or anything. But she couldn't have gotten knocked off. The only thing she could have done was sat back down on the roof.
Wow.
That's, so she was safe.
Wow. So
that's one thing people don't know about stunt people. They think, you know, we're all out daredevil people. Yeah. Not the case at all. You know, people were very, very safety conscious. You know, we practice everything, make sure everything's good, you know, before we ever start doing any of that stuff. It's not like we just go out there and just cowboy up and go.
Yeah, it's not like the olden days, you know, where they used to just, you know, throw a couple mattresses on the ground or boxes and you jump into them.
Yeah, it's a lot different nowadays.
Yeah.
I mean, we still fall into the boxes, though.
Wow. Have you ever done that? Have you ever done the tall building, like the jumps like that?
Yeah, but nothing anywhere near that high. I mean, okay. I've gone like 40 feet.
Okay.
I actually did one that was about 25 feet where I got kicked out of a helicopter into a 5-foot by 7-foot pad, which is a lot of people think when a helicopter hovers, it's perfectly still.
No.
No. I mean, it's going all over the place. And to try and hit a 5-foot by 7-foot target while you're moving, not that easy.
Yeah. Yeah. And especially at that low because you get a lot of current. I mean, you're getting a lot of updraft from the rotor wash.
Yeah, we're getting backdraft off. It was funny. When we did this movie, they had one of the double rotor helicopters. No, it was actually just the one big single rotor. And as it came in, we had the stuff, the pad staked down to the ground, and we had all these tents. It was at the place where they used to do MASH, the TV show.
Sure.
And as it comes flying in, all the tents pulled up. The pad was vibrating so hard, I thought it was going to take off into outer space. And my friend, who is the director, comes running across the field up to me, and he looks at me, and his eyes are like the size of pie plates, and he looks at me, and he goes, "You don't have to do this if you don't want to." Because he had no idea, I mean, that it was going to be this, all this was going to be going on.
That's funny. That's funny. Have you ever been in a situation where you're sitting there going, I picked the wrong profession?
Pretty much every day.
Well, I mean, for obvious reasons. I mean, where you're doing assignment, I know you guys are safety conscious and everything. And yeah, and I know your safety teams are usually 2 or 3 deep where you have guys looking after guys, or gals and stuff. But I mean, have you ever gotten where you're like, you want me to do what? And, you know.
Yeah, I have. I actually went out to work on a movie. I didn't know the guy that called me up. And he says, "Here's what I want you to do. I want you to jump down from there." And I said, "Up there." And it was about 22 feet high.
Sure.
And I said, "What am I landing in?" He goes, "Well, right here on the cement. And then I want you to fight." I said, "You want me to jump 22 feet down onto cement?"
Yeah.
Yeah, it's not
going to
happen.
Why don't you show me how it's done? I'd be like, "Yeah, director, why don't you show me how it's done?"
And yeah. Wasn't the director, it was the other one of the stunt guys. And he says, well, I'll get another guy to do it. Another guy came up and he goes, all right, I want you to jump down from there. And the guy goes, into what? And he goes, all right, we're not doing this.
Wow. Yeah. All right. Well, hang loose, Rick. We're going to come back, and I promise we will talk about the Hollywood ghost hunters. But we are talking with our very special guest tonight, Rick McCallum. He's a stuntman extraordinaire. But more importantly, he is the co-founder of Hollywood Ghost Hunters. Hang in there. We'll be back in a few.
This is the Midnight Ocean with Jeff Norton on the Paranormal State Radio Network. With Jeff Norton on the Paranormal State Radio Network.
That is right, Andrew. It is the the Midnight Ocean Radio Show and Podcast. I am your host. You can join me here live every weeknight from 10 p.m. till 2 a.m. Eastern Standard Time or on the web at www.themidnightocean.com. If you're looking for us on social media, it's very easy. All you have to do is go to the search bar and type in The Midnight Ocean, and we're usually the first ones that pop up. So, couldn't make it any easier than that. Wow, what a show we have in store for you. We're talking with our very special guest, Rick McCallum. He is a known stunt man, but also known in the ghost hunting community as one of the co-founders of Hollywood Ghost Hunters. And we have him on the line, and we're talking to him tonight. And I do promise we'll stop talking about the stunt work. Let's get into the meat of it, Rick. You ready?
I am ready.
You are ready. All right. So you and Kane started, and as you said, Kane is known as Jason. He played what four of the Jason? How many Jason movies have there been out?
I think there's been 13, maybe, and there's only been one guy played Jason more than once, and that's Kane.
That's Kane. And so,
yeah, he did it for four different movies.
Yeah. So what do you guys do? You guys sitting around, one day talking shop, saying, hey, I'm into ghosts. How does that conversation start?
No, this is actually much, much more exciting than that. I've been interested in ghosts all my life.
Sure.
I mean, I've had so many things happen to me that it's silly. I'm kind of like a ghost magnet. I mean, I go places and things happen. I mean, it's happy because, that's what I'm looking for. So that's a good thing.
Yeah.
But Kane and I were at a place called Mansfield Reformatory, which is actually also Mansfield Prison, which is where they did the Shawshank Redemption, and they did some of Air Force One there. Yeah. And we were doing a movie. And we were already done. It was probably 2 or 3 in the morning, and Kane and I were already done filming, and we were way, way, way back in the cell blocks. And everybody else was gone. So Kane and I started walking back, and there's no lights, just the moonlight coming in. And Kane says to me, he goes, hey, why don't we hunt for ghosts? And I'm thinking, wow, I didn't know he was into this, right? So we're walking along, I go up to the second floor, which is kind of interesting. I go up to the second floor, and I'm walking along, and I feel like this energy coming out of this one room. So I said, hey, man, something weird's going on in here. So I walked in, and it felt like somebody was squeezing my chest. It was real hard to breathe. So I told him, I said, yeah, this place, there's something weird here. And he goes, well, mark it. We'll bring some of the other people in tomorrow. So I didn't have anything on me. So I looked around with my phone, and I looked up, and there was an X somebody put over the door on the inside with a Sharpie. I said, okay. And I looked on the other ones. They didn't have it, so it had to be this one. I said, okay. So it was funny. When I got back home a couple months later, I'm watching Ghost Hunters, and they were at Mansfield, and they had walked along and felt this energy field and went in there, and they actually marked it with the X. So of the 1,000 things that were there, Ghost Hunters and myself both picked the same cell, which is kind of weird. But what happened after that, we go downstairs and we're walking along, and it's, I don't know if you've been to Mansfield, it's probably the cell block's close to 100 yards long.
Yeah, I'm laughing because I got something to share with you, but go ahead.
Yeah, so it's like 100 yards long. It's rusty, and it's if you're going to do a haunted movie prison, this is the place to go, right? So we're walking along, and I see up ahead of me a shadow man way down at the end. And I stop, and I'm looking, and I turn over to look at Kane to see if he sees it, and he's gone. And I thought, oh, great, even the scary Jason guy runs away. I'm never going to find anybody to start a group with, right? And I hear thump, 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 and I turn around, and there he is running straight down the way towards it. I was like, oh, yeah, now we got something to work with.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Jason has arrived. Yeah, Jason's here.
Yeah. Kane. So that I found out that he was really into it, and when he was growing up on Kwajalein Island, he used to go to the Japanese bunkers and try and ghost hunt in there, and so that's actually when we started it, and then we brought in Ari Mihailov, who's more famous for playing Leatherface in Texas Chainsaw Massacre. So that was the start of our group.
That's amazing. I have to ask this question. When you guys, all right, so you got Jason, you got Leatherface, you got you. Have you guys ever, like, just ghost, in character? I mean, and I'm just, you know, I know that's
immature. As a matter of fact, yeah, because the last thing you want to do when you do movies is get dressed up on Halloween.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, I mean, all of us spend a lot of time, you know, like some of the characters I've played have taken, you know, 3 hours to put the makeup on and 2 hours to get it off. And Kane's have been longer, you know, so that we don't really do that. But I have been, it's funny, I was at a Paracon and somebody asked me a question. They said, what is it like ghost hunting with Jason and Leatherface? And I said, well, you know, it's a double-edged sword. I'll be walking down this real long hallway and it's dark and creepy, and off on one side I got Jason, on the other side I got Leatherface, and I'm thinking, oh, this is not going to end well for me.
This is not going to bode well. I got two of the greatest, you know, gore movie
slashers
ever. And I'm hanging out with them. And, you know, see, I can only imagine this is really funny because this is the kind of guy that I am, the prankster I am. See, if I was a Jason, if I was Leather, I would wear those costumes out in public. I would, just to mess with people. I'd be driving my car, you know, around the highway, or, you know, or get myself a Harley, you know, and just be cruising along, or, you know, in Texas. I would. You got to mess with people. Life's too short, man.
Well, I will tell you, Kane is probably the biggest prankster of anybody in the movie business.
I can imagine.
When we were at Mansfield, they have a huge haunted house at Halloween.
Yeah.
And a friend of ours, Myron St. John, who is also one of the producers of the movie we were doing there, runs the haunted house. So me and Kane asked him, he said, well, where do you got all the stuff for the haunted house? He goes, downstairs. So me and Kane go downstairs and we get this thing that looks like Angus Scrim, you know, the scary guy. We go down and we get it, and we bring it up, and you have to go through the cell block. You know, there's some small places you have to go through. So we sneak up with this dummy and stand it, and Kane wants to stand it right in the thing. I said, no, not right in it. Put it back just a little bit so you can see the shadow, and somebody has to lean in to see what it is. So we put it in there, and we walk away, and we've probably gotten 40 or 50 yards. And he goes, do you think anybody's going to see it? And all of a sudden, we hear this girl, this blood-curdling scream. And, and I said, yeah, I'm going to say yes.
Yeah, mission accomplished.
I'm going to say yes.
Wow. I mean, I can imagine the stories and how much fun it is with you guys, hunting with you guys. Because, like I said, there's just something really bizarre about hunting with Leatherface, ghost hunting with Leatherface and Jason. I mean, it's just
it is interesting.
It just doesn't seem right. It just doesn't seem normal. But
we show up in the ghost sleeve.
Yeah. You know? Yeah. They're like, no, dude, yeah, I don't want nothing to do with you.
They're scarier than we are. Yeah, let's get out of here.
Yeah. I mean, well, you guys are big guys, though, too. I mean,
that is true. A lot of people don't realize some of the size of some of the people in our group.
Yeah.
Like, I'm 6'4", I weigh 250. Kane's probably, you know, 6'4", 235. R.A. is 6'5", 320.
Yeah.
We got another guy who does all the creature effects, a guy named Robert, who's 6'5", 320.
Yeah.
Another guy who's 6'3", 280. I mean, you know, we go inside and we have to go on different sides of the building so it doesn't tip over.
Yeah. Well, it's funny. I fit right in with your group because I am 6'5", and I've got a good 100 pounds on all of you.
Sweet.
I'm a big dude. It was funny. I was on an airplane. I was coming back from Puerto Rico on an air flight, and I was sitting, well, across from us was sitting the center for the Miami Dolphins. And he was looking at me, and I kept on looking at him because obviously I knew who he was, and well, I knew his brother. Yeah. And so I'm looking at him, and I'm sitting there, and he's looking at me, and finally he's like, "Who did you play for?" Because I'm much older. "Who did you play for?" And I'm like, "I never played professional." He goes, "Oh man," he goes, "you could have been." And I'm like, "I was not this size when I was your age. I was into the rock climbing." Well, see, I was into the rock climbing, the parachuting, the bungee jumping, all of the, you know, all of those things, climbing rocks and stuff like that. And it just age and lack of motion, you know, kind of got to me.
Yeah, I'm more just the opposite. I'm more into falling off of all of those things.
Well, that's usually what ended it for me was the falling, breaking ankles, breaking legs, and tearing shoulders out of sockets and stuff like that. It kind of leads to a sediment. You know, that's when you go, well, I got to stop doing this and start looking for a profession that's a little bit less dangerous. So I sit behind a keyboard. The only thing I got to worry about is paper cut.
Well, you know what? I can break my leg. You can shoot me, you know, throw me down the stairs. But if I get a head cold or a paper cut, I want to go immediately to the Mayo Clinic.
Wow.
I mean, I'm the biggest baby when it comes to like a paper cut. I hate those things.
They hurt. Well, yeah, it's the little ones that get you and everything. So you and Kane, so you guys started this and when did you start Hollywood Ghost Hunters?
Probably about 7 years ago.
Yeah. And then you guys are grown. You've grown quite a bit. You've got how many active investigators do you have with you guys now?
We have 14.
Sure.
A lot of them don't get to go out that often because we're all in the movie business, and everybody, like right now, if we tried to do something, Kane is in Chicago, Ari is in Pennsylvania, I'm here. Mm-hmm. You know, it's hard to get everybody together. So, you know, a lot of times we end up just investigating by ourselves. You know, I have other people here, obviously, in California that go with me, like Robert Pendergraft does. Lewis goes with me. You know, we have other people. Ed Ackerman, he played one of the Visigoths in the Capital One commercials.
Okay.
You know, the Viking kind of guys.
Yeah, yeah.
And he also was in Hatchet 2.
Sure.
He was one of the victims in there.
Sure.
So, wow. But yeah, we do. We get to go to quite a few places in the amount of time that we've been doing this. I mean, Kane has been at the Stanley Hotel. Ari has been at Trans-Allegheny Lunatic Asylum. We've all went to Waverly. We went to Sloss Furnaces in Alabama. We went to Old South Pittsburgh in Tennessee. We've been to the Omen House, which is up on the hill here, right next to where the Manson family killed Sharon Tate. Mm. Been to the Houdini Estate. I mean, we've been all over the place. We went to actually Clive Barker's house. Kane and I ghost hunted it by ourselves, which is really cool. Clive Barker's house, you know, he's the one who wrote Hellraiser.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and directed it and all that stuff, as far as I remember. But, you know, that was a very cool place to go. Personally, I've been over to Scotland a lot lately, and I just did a really cool investigation at a little place called the Pioneer Saloon outside Vegas.
What in all of your travels and all of your hunting and stuff, what's the one that sticks in your head the most that you kind of go, wow, this well, that was intense?
I think was the one at Pioneer Saloon.
Okay.
The one that just happened.
And why was that?
Well, Pioneer Saloon is, for the people who don't know, it's been on Ghost Adventures. It's been on a lot of different things. Well, we've been on Ghost Adventures too, you know. So, but anyway, I went out there. I was talking to the people, and it's an old time, you know, actual real saloon, 30 miles, you know, from Las Vegas, kind of like out, you know, towards the desert area, just a little tiny town. And they had murders and all kinds of stuff happen in the saloon. So I wanted to investigate it, and I went out there. I got invited. So I go out there, and like I said, I've been all over the place. I mean, and I've been in more ghost hunting places than you can possibly imagine. And I get out there, and I'm in one side off in the, where they have like, you know, you can get something to eat, and it's a gift shop and stuff. And then we go into this other place. We go by a bar, and then there's a private room where one guy got shot for cheating at cards. Another woman got strangled there. There's been a bunch of people get killed there. But we sit down, and there's probably eight of us at these two round tables, and I'm sitting at the table where the guy got shot, and I have two K2 meters, the ones that have the five lights on them.
Sure.
One of them is mine, and one of them is the girl next to me, but because we were in a circle, hers was like it was in front of me too. And all of a sudden, all 10 lights on the two K2 meters in front of me start lighting up, just going crazy. And nothing, everybody else has K2 meters, REM pods, and everything else around the table. Nothing's going off, just this. So it goes like that for about 20 seconds and stops. So the girl continues talking, and all of a sudden, I mean, I just, the thing comes back. They light up again, and I got instantly so sick to my stomach. I mean, I was like as sick as I've ever been. I was like, you know, doing everything I could not to make a mess. Wow. And I'm sitting there, and the girl goes like this. She looks at the thing, and she goes, wow, the spirits must really like you. And I said, I'm not so sure they do, right? Because they don't know what's going on. And they have a tape of this. They were filming it, and they were getting audio. And after I said, I'm not so sure they do, there's a girl's voice that goes, we do, which was pretty interesting.
Right? Wow.
That answered the question. So I'm still sitting there, and I said, yeah, something else is going on. And the girl says, what's the matter? And I said, now this isn't, you know, it's hot where I was at. It's in the desert, right?
Yeah.
So I'm sitting there, and I said, something else is going on. She goes, what? I said, touch my forehead. And she goes, oh, my God, you're as cold as ice. And the girl next to me reaches over, touches my arm. She goes, wow. She says, you are. You're as cold as ice. And I said, yeah, there's something going on. And then we heard with our own ears, which we also picked up on tape, we hear, Rick. Another girl's voice, right? Not the same one as the first one, but another one.
Yeah.
So I said to him, I said, look, I'm going to go outside, catch some air and stuff. So, you know, you guys keep investigating. I'm just going to see if I can get away from this sickness. So as I'm walking by one of the girls who is sitting there, I'm maybe a foot and a half, a little farther away from her as I walk by. And she goes, holy cow, you can feel how cold he is even when he walks this far away from you. So, I mean, it was really, really intense how cold I got. But I got outside and I'm standing there and I start to feel better. And Jill, the girl that invited me there, she comes out and she talks to me. And I said, let's go back in. I'm feeling better. We walked inside the door, and all of a sudden, I felt like I got hit by a bus. I mean, wow. I'm as sick as I can be again. And I sit down for a minute or two, and, you know, I sat there for a minute or two, and I said, guys, you know, I'm pretty much sure. And I started to walk away, and on the tape, it goes, turn Rick back.
Turn Rick, you know, back.
Yeah. So I'm sitting there and I, you know, standing there, and I just said, guys, you know, I don't want to ruin your evening. I feel really terrible. I'm going to take off. Right. It was nice meeting you. And I start to walk away, and on the tape, it says, release him. So that was
wow.
The most interactive thing I've ever had happen. I mean, I've had things bump me, push me, almost got pushed down the stairs down in San Diego. Something hit me from behind. Fortunately, I was able to catch myself before I did a header all the way down.
Wow. And you actually, you know, you didn't stumble or anything. You actually felt, did you have physical, like a mark or a bruise or anything where they hit you?
No, actually what happened was we were down at a place called the William Heath Davis House, which is the oldest house in San Diego.
Sure.
That's a museum. And I was there as a guest of the San Diego Ghost Hunters, who also took me to the Whaley House, which is another world famous place. But anyway, I was there with a girl that I had invited to go with me, because every once in a while, if somebody hooks us up with a place to ghost hunt,
mm-hmm.
one of my rules is if you get us to the location, you can come with us, right? So I had this girl, Brandy, who was with us, and we started to go downstairs, and the girls were downstairs, the San Diego ghost hunting girls, and they were doing a spirit box session. So Brandy hears it. She goes, well, let's sit here on the stairs. And I was already ahead of her. She sat down at the top stairs. She goes, let's sit on the stairs, wait till they're done. And fortunately, I had just started to sit. My big butt was almost to the, you know, the stair.
Yeah.
And something right in the middle of my back just shoved me. I mean, I was not almost sitting down. I still had like a foot or so to go, so I was still mostly upright. But fortunately, I was going backwards when this hit. And I almost hit my face on my knees. It threw me forward so fast.
Wow.
Right? So I caught myself before I went down the stairs, and Brandy screams. And the girls come running out, and they go, what's going on? She goes, Mike, something shoved him.
Yeah. So she actually saw it.
She was right behind me. She was like maybe two or three stairs behind me. And I mean, she was.
Wow.
Yeah, she saw this.
Yeah.
But the weird thing was, later on, Maritza, the girl who invited me, calls me up. She goes, listen to this. And they're doing another spirit box session. And she goes, okay, who pushed Rick? And it goes, spirits. And she goes, spirits? More than one spirit? Why? How many spirits pushed Rick? And it goes, five.
Five spirits.
And she goes, five spirits. Why did five spirits push Rick? And it goes, he's big.
Yeah, he's big. I was gonna, that's the way. For those that don't know, what is a spirit box? What is that?
Spirit box is like a little thing that will actually pick words out of the air that that you can communicate with. You know, you'll sit there, and a lot of times, you know, you won't get anything that makes any sense. It'll say like lint or elbow or macaroni or something like that.
Sure.
But a lot of times, you know, if you're connecting with something, you can get Like you could say, what's your name? And you'll hear Karen. You know, all of a sudden a name will come through and you'll find out that Karen was actually somebody who died in the building. So it could be a pretty interesting thing. And I'll tell you how interesting, because there's more to this. We went down and sat down on the floor down there, and all the girls, there was five of us there, we're sitting there and they're doing the spirit box, and all of a sudden it goes, can't remember exactly, I'll paraphrase, but it goes, outside, beware, men, right? So the girl gets up, she looks out the window, and she goes, Rick, come here. So I go over there, and there's three drunk guys trying to pry open the gate to get in. So she goes down and tells them, this is a museum, you can't come in here. And they said, we're coming in anyway, right? And they started yanking on the gate and stuff. Yeah. So I walked down there, I said, you're not coming in, this is private property. And they said, oh, yes, we are. And I said, oh, no, you're not. And they said, who is going to stop us? I said, you're looking at them,
yeah.
Right? So they start swearing at me and yelling, and they start flipping us off and stuff, and they leave. Which I wasn't really afraid, because the girl who was standing on the stairs was actually an NCIS agent. So I figured that she might jump in there and bite somebody if things got too, you know. But the fact that it said, beware outside men.
Yeah.
And we look outside and there's men trying to break in. I mean, that was a pretty cool spirit box thing there.
So the spirit box, is it like white noise? Is it a tape recording? Is it a, I'm just trying to, our listening audience who might not know what one is, I mean, how does it work?
Well, it really works by running through radio channels on a frequency. Oh. And what it'll do is it'll pick up words.
Okay.
And that's how it'll actually...
So it's like in the movie Christine, right? Or Transformers, where Bumblebee's talking to him, where it's playing. It goes through the radio frequency and picks out words from... Okay.
Yeah, and it's just, you know, usually it'll only say one word, you know. But sometimes every once in a while you get two words, you know. Sure. But it's pretty interesting, because like I say, when it actually is germane to what you're doing, that's when you're like, okay, this is pretty cool.
This is. And what is the, I mean, has there been any kind of like statistical analysis? Because I mean, I've once heard that if you throw enough words up against the wall, and you do it over a repetitive amount of time, eventually you will create Shakespeare. I mean, like the Hamlet or one of the plays. I mean,
well,
mathematically.
That's what they say.
Yeah.
But this thing doesn't really work that way.
Okay.
I mean, it's for just a simple reason. It doesn't throw off words over and over and over and over again. You may go a half an hour and it won't say a single thing. You know, you just hear white noise. You know?
Sure.
And then you'll say... is there anybody here with us? And you'll hear, yes. You know, it'll actually respond in something that is a response to what you're actually asking, you know. So it can be pretty interesting. Sometimes it's just radio noise.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, sometimes it's just radio noise. It means absolutely nothing. But when it does, when something does hook up or appears to, because you can never be absolutely positive. But, I mean, when you ask a straight question... You know, did you die here? And it goes, yes. How'd you die? Murder. Okay.
Sure.
You start going, okay, this is interesting.
Now, do these spirit boxes have internal, like, recordings where it's recording the whole thing, or is it just, or are you
No,
guys,
you have to have a, you, an you external. Gotta have your own, you know, external one going.
Okay. Yeah, because, you know, I'm a science kind of guy. So, you know, yes, and yes is one of those, it's a very common word, right? So, how often does that come up? So I guess my question is has anybody done, you know, taken a recording of, you know, this recording, seeing the distribution of names and then seeing how, you know, how common they come up, and then doing a correlate, you know, my science side is kicking into me. You got to understand, I'm a data analytics guy. So that's, you know, one of the things I look at, and then look at and say, is this abnormal? You know, was there something that was abnormal about this? Or was it an instance of, it's kind of like, I call it the new car syndrome. And the new car syndrome is where you go buy a new car. And once you buy the new car, you realize that there's 20 or 30, you never realized this before, but now you're hypersensitive to it because you see 20, 30 of your car driving on the road, because that's what you're now cognitive of that car and that color and that style and everything. But you have to wait until after the break to answer that, Rick, because like I said,
time to think.
Yeah, he gives you time to think. But you know, I'm interested in this because I'm a science guy, so I'll let you know. And but we're talking with our very special guest, Rick McCallum, as he's going through. And wow, can you imagine? Can you imagine? I can tell you, I've shared it on this show. And I was calling my priest friends right away. When they start, it's one thing when they start talking to you. It's another thing when they start physically interacting with you, touching you. And I'll tell you, it's one of the craziest things you'll ever experience. But we'll be back with our very special guest, Rick McCallum.
This is the Midnight Ocean with Jeff Norton on the Paranormal State Radio Network.
This is the Midnight Ocean Radio Show and podcast. I am your host, Jeff Norton, your master of ceremonies, your captain of this ship tonight. The only captain. We don't have any other captains. I don't even have a first mate. Need to find one, though. Fill in so I can take a little vacation. Not saying I don't like doing this, but hey, come on. Everybody needs a little time off here and there. I hope you guys have plans for next week. We'll lay out next week's schedule as well for the show and everything. But we'll deal with next week when next week comes. Right now, let's deal with the here and now. Here, you are watching us on YouTube or listening to us on Spreaker or through one of our many affiliates. I just have to say, if you're watching on YouTube, make sure you hit that subscribe button. I would appreciate it very much. If you are listening to us on one of our affiliates and stuff, please, please make sure you get over to Spreaker. Go to Spreaker.com, S-P-R-E-A-K-E-R.com, and follow us there. We are talking with them about getting on iHeartRadio, and there's some requirements that we have to meet before we can get on iHeart. But how cool would that be on iHeart? You know, taking our show to millions of potential listeners. It would be astronaut. It would just be incredible, guys. And the only way that we can do that is with your help, your support, and your love. And to show the love, get out there, hit the subscribe button, or to hit the follow button on Spreaker. And of course, you can also follow us on social media. We promise you, if you do follow us, we will not spam you. We're to send you information about the shows and our guests that we are going to have or that we have online. And right now, we have Rick McCallum joining us all the way from L.A., and he is the co-founder of Hollywood Ghost Hunter. So Rick, right before we went on break, I'm a statistical guy, so I'm going to look at the numbers. I'm going to look at the data, and it's, you know, I've seen these spirit boxes, and they seem cool. There's no doubt about it, but I'm wondering how random. I'm wondering if you're actually being communicated to, or if it's one of these things where you're being sensitive. You know, you're going to pick out the words that you want to hear in this litany of repetition of these words, and then you're just picking those out. And I'm not saying it's not true. I mean, I've always had that question about spirit boxes.
Well, I think it's a good question. I mean, I'd love to see somebody actually do that.
Sure.
Although a lot of people have a misconception about the spirit box. It doesn't spit out a lot of words. Oh. You may go 10 minutes and it'll never say a thing. So, I mean, it's not like usually it's just word after word and it's catching things as it's flipping through frequencies. If you ever watch Ghost Adventures, they use that quite a bit with a speaker. You'll see them walking around and you can hear the thing going until that word comes through.
Oh.
So, I mean, it's not as random. It's not like there's 100 words and you pick out the 5 that might be, you know, apply to what you're asking.
Sure.
You know, you may only get 5 words the whole night. So, I mean, but it would be interesting to see what it does. But like I say, the one that happened down there, beware men outside. And right at that time, there's 3 men trying to break through the lock and get into the museum.
Sure. Sure. Okay.
That one's pretty interesting.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. And that's got to really just rock you. I mean, when you hear stuff like that, I mean, that's just got to, I mean, obviously you're a believer, right? Without a doubt.
Well, yeah, without a doubt. Like I said, I've been touched, pushed. I've had things whisper in my ear. I mean, I've been doing it for a long time though.
Yeah.
You know, it's a lot of people have just started with ghost hunters coming on TV.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, I actually, my first paranormal experience was when I was 13 years old, which is more than a couple of years ago.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, how do you feel about shows like Ghost Hunters and things of that nature? I know, you know, a lot of the guys in the business and stuff. Do you think that those types of shows actually help in ghost investigation, or do you think that it kind of leads a lot of, I don't want to say idiots, but I'll say, I just said it. So does it open up the door for a lot of idiots who run around with their PK meters?
Yeah, I would never call anybody idiots. But,
yeah.
I would say there are a lot of people out there ghost hunting that shouldn't. just to be honest with you. Yeah. And yes, it did open up a door, and it was good that it opened up the door, made the paranormal more mainstream.
Sure.
Which made it a lot easier to get into a lot of places. But as more and more and more shows come on, it makes it much harder to get into places because everybody is calling them trying to get in.
Yeah.
So, but a lot of the stuff that they do is actually, you know, good if you follow what they're doing. You know, see which equipment they're using and, you know, well, I'll give you, for instance, one of the things when I take people ghost hunting with me for the first time, they've all seen, you know, Zach and Nick and Aaron, you know, from Ghost Adventures, all asking questions, you know, to try and get an EVP, which is a voice on tape that, you know, sure. You don't hear. And, you know, they'll all see that. But when you give them the recorder and say, okay, ask them questions, and they'll go, did you die here? Did you live here? How old are you? What is your name? It's like, hold on a second. Do you talk to people like that?
Yeah.
They go, what do you mean? I said, give it some time to answer. You know, it's like, you know, is there anyone here with us?
Yeah.
You know, give it 15 seconds to answer. If you go, is anyone here with us? Did you live here? You know, it's like, come on, guys. Don't get so excited. Relax. Yeah. We're down.
Yeah. Well, I mean, just the nature in it. So, and I do have to apologize. I don't want to say idiots because that's wrong. But it is a wrong term to use. And I don't want to disparage anybody.
Not really, because there are some people that do idiotic things.
Yeah.
You know, one of the idiotic things that a lot of people are doing now is trespassing.
Well, and that's the
bad idea.
That's the big one. Is I think that's what's ruining it for a lot of people. Is the fact that you get a lot of people who feel like kind of like those three drunken guys that we're just going to, you know, commit. We're going to break an entry. You know, break into a house, or we're going to, you know, this is physical property. People own this property, and you got to get the proper permissions, or you're going to ruin it for everybody.
Exactly. Yeah. So that's what I mean. And I wasn't cracking on you for calling them idiots, honestly. Yeah.
Well, I should be better. I shouldn't use words like those. Are hateful words, and I try not to use them because I think it goes right down to the core as an individual too. So I try. Rick, we're all about love here.
Sweet.
Yeah, we're all about love here. See, I tell you, I'd fit in well in L.A. if I wasn't so fat.
Yeah, you would fit in well. And what do you mean? You're so fat. Just hang out with us. Nobody noticed.
That's right. Well, Rodney Danger. Yeah, see, I would be the Rodney Danger. Remember that one line. If you think you're fat, get bigger friends. So I'd make you guys look skinny.
Well, see, that's a general idea.
It's all right.
But you know what's really funny about our group? With the people that we have, I mean, all of us in horror movies and them, sure. You know, a lot of the people playing iconic horror people like Jason and Leatherface. The one thing that we don't do when we ghost hunt,
yeah. We
never provoke the spirits.
Really?
A lot of groups will go in and they'll act like tough guys.
Well, yeah.
Like, you think you're, you know, scary, you know, it's like, yeah. You know, calm down. Yeah. And actually, I was on Coast to Coast AM one night and they played a EVP that I had. And somebody called in, they said, you are the most polite ghost hunter we've ever heard. And I said, let me ask you something. If I came over to your house and I walked in and I started screaming at you to get me a soda and a sandwich, you know, or if I walked in and said, hi, my name's Rick, how are you? Who would you rather talk to?
Yeah. Yeah.
And I said, you're trying to get something, you know, a spirit to, you know, connect with you. And you're going to start off by yelling and screaming at it?
Yeah. Well, I think, you know, we talk about Zach and so, you know, that's Zach's technique and whatever works for him, I guess works for him. But yeah, I wouldn't want to be yelling and screaming at something that has the potential of pushing me down a flight of stairs.
I'm going to stick up for Zach though, because like I said, I know Zach pretty well. I have a magazine called Hollywood Ghost Hunters Magazine.
Yeah.
And he was the first person that I interviewed. I also interviewed Nick Groff. So I know those guys pretty well.
Yeah.
But when those guys will provoke, and it's not so much that they hardly do it, but it's when they go to some place that is supposedly haunted by very evil spirits.
Ah.
So it's not like they're you know, causing somebody unrest, you know.
Sure.
It's something that's nasty and needs to be addressed.
So, okay. So that, then yeah. That's because, like I said, when I'm flipping through the channels and I do watch, you know, the Ghost Hunter shows. And so when I do see them, and the one with Zach, you know, I saw the one where they scratched him. I saw that one where they scratched, and he got belligerent. And I'm sitting there going, wait a minute, Zach, I can understand you being upset. Don't get me wrong. I mean, you know, if someone scratches you, but something just scratched you that you can't see and no one else saw. I mean, why would you provoke it?
Well, there's another way of looking at this. If you have gotten to the point where something has scratched you,
yeah,
you have its attention. And it's time to, you know, up the ante a little bit.
Sure.
And especially if you're doing a TV show and you're getting something that cool,
yeah,
what might come next if you can get its attention?
Yeah, that's true. Well, on that episode, I think they caught that brick flying. So it was throwing bricks at them in that same episode.
That was their original one. The brick came at them, and then all the wood fell over in the back, and you know that was. Yeah. That's what really launched them.
Yeah. I mean, it was cool. I mean, you know, I'll catch Zach and every once in a while and so, but I'm glad that you did clarify that, because I never really thought of it that way, that usually, you know, when he's yelling or when he's provoking is usually when he's dealing with a not so friendly ghost.
You know, with someone that has a history. I mean, we do run across some that are just downright nasty.
Yeah.
You know, so sometimes that's, you know, the way to go. I mean, I try to be as polite as I can, but when things start shoving you down the stairs,
yeah,
you know, there's no sense kid gloving it anymore.
Do you talk directly, you know, in that instance, do you get up and say, hey, WTF, you know, what are you thinking?
As soon as I did that, I just turned around. I went, oh, that was pretty close. You know, just try and keep that. I'll tell you, when we were at Old South Pittsburgh Hospital, they had a thing where they would hear an old-time telephone ring at 1:30 in the morning.
Sure.
Well, in this building, there are no telephone lines. Okay? So there's no telephones. There's no physical telephones in there either. So, and we were up on the third floor, and we're walking through there, and all of a sudden we hear ring, ring, an old-time telephone. I was like, wow, that really does happen. So we went all around the place trying to find anything where there might be a phone. We opened cabinets. We went everywhere from where we heard it. Nothing. So I'm walking along and I said, well, you know, that was pretty good. I mean, you know, we hear that it comes and that did happen, but it's going to take something a little bigger than that to convince me. What do you got? And right in front of me, about 10 feet away, which you can actually see on our website, HollywoodGhostHunters.com. If you look up Old South Pittsburgh, you'll hear it happen. I said, you know, what else you got? And about 10 feet in front of me, you know, the steel doors that have the push bars.
Yeah, yeah.
You know,
yeah.
to get out.
The fire doors.
One of these doors, you can hear it go, blam! I mean, like two big, strong guys swung it as hard as they could.
Wow.
And, I mean, everybody jumped, and I stood there and went, okay, now that was pretty good. Yeah, that was pretty good. Much better than the phone.
But see, a good goes on, you probably, all right, that was good. Now what else you got for me?
That was pretty good.
Have you?
You know, but there are some that are just like that. I mean, you'll say do something and something will happen. Other times you'll go out some places, and a lot of people don't understand this. You know, most of the time when you go to someplace ghost hunting, nothing happens. You'll be there for 3 or 4 hours walking around, and maybe you'll get a blip on your K2 meter, and you know, but nothing happens.
Yeah, and a K2 meter is an electrical device. It senses electrical activity, correct? Or like,
well, it picks up electromagnetic field.
Sure.
And what you do when you take one of those is you go into, say you're going to do a house, you go into the house and you walk all through the house to see, to get a base reading,
mm-hmm.
you know, to see what is actually firing off in there. I mean, Wi-Fi will set it off. Microwaves can set it off. What's really interesting, if you take it to an electrical socket and hold it up, it'll only go to 2. There's 5 lights. So when you're standing in a room that had no activity at all, and all of a sudden it starts going 3, 4, and 5 lights, something else of electromagnetic field has come very close to you to make that go off.
Sure. Now, can you make, because we're energy, can you make it go off?
Nope.
So it doesn't pick up your energy. I mean, we have enough energy in our body to, wow.
No, doesn't pick up people.
Wow. So it's just, it's the electromagnetic around you. That's great.
Yeah.
It seems like most of your interactions with ghosts have been auditory in nature, except you have a few physical. I mean, have you had any visual? I know you said that you saw a dark figure, but did you see anything like of definite shape and form that you could actually tell who it was or sex or whatever? Yeah. Wow.
Well, couldn't really tell the sex on them, but
What I'm saying is, could you see like a dress, like a flowing dress, or a guy wearing a cowboy hat? Then that's what I'm saying. No, I'm not. Can I see your junk? No, it's not like that.
I wasn't being a smartass about that. I was thinking, we couldn't have told anything we've seen. You couldn't have told what sex it was because it was like more of a shape. You know, that you wouldn't be able to identify if it's a man or a woman. It's kind of where I was going with that.
Okay.
Instead of sounding so
well, snarky, I don't know. Like I mean, you know, see, there you go. See, that's why ghost hunting, I'm a little, because I'm the type of guy who's like, you know, I'll crack jokes, man.
we do too as we walk along. I mean, it's pretty funny. I actually have seen things. Other people in my group have seen them.
Sure.
We actually have things that we have caught on video. I have to get my web guy in there because I've got about five or six really good ones that need to go up.
Yeah.
But if you go to HollywoodGhostHunters.com and go over to the side that says evidence, and if you go to hallway one and hallway two and look at those two, I guarantee you just go, what? What the hell was that? Because they're both up at the place right next to where the Mansons killed Sharon Tate and all those people.
Wow.
And it's this one hallway, and it's, we actually set a camera on the floor with nobody in the building, and you will see something move in both of them. And I don't mean a piece of something. You'll see something cross the camera. That's pretty interesting. I mean, I've got pictures of shadows of legs walking, you know, you see on the wall behind us where we're standing, and you see us standing there, so you know it's not us. You know, different things like that. I mean, I'll tell you one that happened in Scotland, in the Southbridge vaults, their underground vaults.
Yeah.
Whenever I take a picture with my camera or my phone, I always take two in a row, click, click, just to see if anything changes. Well, they had a story of a lady in white down at one end that they always see. So I'm standing in there. We're underground. There's no other light source in there. All the lights except for a couple very small ones are on, right? Nothing's on except for those small lights. And I say, okay, I understand there's a lady down at the end of the tunnel here that shows once in a while. I click the picture. And I said, so if you could, you know, show it to us. And I clicked the picture, you know. And I looked at it. In the first one, nothing. In the second one, there's a white shape that's roughly the same size as what you would think would be a woman. So that one was pretty interesting.
Yeah, see, I'm looking at the hallway. All right, so the evidence one. Do I have your permission? Can I put this up on the web?
Absolutely.
I mean, up on the go-to. I just want to, because I want to share this with the audience, and I like to ask just for legal reasons. Let me see here.
Yeah, well, a lot of our stuff is up on YouTube,
yes.
Also under Hollywood Ghost Hunters. But yeah. I got to put more stuff up there.
Yeah, so I got your case footage, so we're playing. I don't know how well this is going to it's not going to show. Actually, it looks
like you're... Well, like I said, they can go to Hollywood Ghost Hunters on YouTube, and there'll be different things there.
Yeah, yeah.
There's one of the same hallway where I'm walking down the hallway, and it has recessed lights through the ceiling.
Sure.
And I turn off the lights, and I start to walk down the hallway, and I go about maybe 8 feet, and all the lights come on. And I turn around and look at my friend, Richard, who's a director. I turn around and said, you see that? He goes, I did see you turn the lights off. Yes. And he turns the light off again. I start walking, and all of a sudden, the lights start going independently of each other.
Yeah.
You know, blinking here. One would go there. One would go here, which they're all on the same circuit. They can't do that.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that was pretty interesting. I even told the owner, I said, and the lights were all, he says, they're all on the same circuit. So, I mean, you're a tech guy. I mean, One here, one here in the middle. I mean, one back here, yeah. All on the same circuit.
It'd be different if they're parallel, right? But yeah, being on the same. All right, so here we go. I'm hallway evidence two. I'm playing it on the web. I can see, and this is crazy. This is insane. I clearly see like a mist moving across the screen at the bottom left. Yeah.
Well, there's one, if you look, it's about in the center. It's on the left. And what it appears to me to be is something that looks like maybe a tomahawk or maybe a baton. And it comes onto the wall.
Yes.
And it's transparent, but you can see it. And it spins in midair and vanishes.
Yeah, it's spinning. It's like, you're absolutely right. But it's at a low, I mean, it's only like a foot to 2 feet off the ground because of the angle of the camera.
Yeah.
Yeah,
yeah, it's not real high, but I mean, it's hard to explain what it is. I mean, there's obviously something you can see transparent spinning in midair.
Now, could that be...
The other one that's on hallway one is even weirder.
Yeah, I'm looking at that now. We have that up there on YouTube and everything.
That it goes by very fast, too, so you got to be watching the bottom.
Yeah.
But what I do on those things, too, so you can see them, is I slow them down to 1/8 speed.
1/8 speed, yeah.
Yeah, so you can see them, you know. The one in the hallway, you can see it actually forming.
Now, yeah, this one here, I'm wondering if that's, then you get the image at the bottom. It's like a reflection off the floor, which, you know, to that one there, and that's the thing. I see guys that look at it and they, these are ore. Oh, wait. But wait a minute here. Rick, at the very end, you guys cut the video off. Something's forming in the doorway at the very end of this video.
Of hallway one?
Of hallway one.
Yeah, you know, I did see that when I was first looking through it.
Yeah.
And I'm not so sure that that's not a matter of the autofocus.
Okay. And, well, that was going to be my question on the other ones is how many of these... Because I'm looking, all right, so I saw the thing, yep, fly across. Now I'm looking at the doorway, and, well, in 1/8 speed, you can clearly see something kind of manifesting in the, all right, so I see it go across. That is bizarre. That's not a bug, because it's
no, it's
long,
not a bug,
yeah.
Because you can see it manifest.
Yeah.
And as it goes by, you know, it's so funny that people look at it and so many people see different things. Some people say it looks like a lady's head. Other people say it looks like a baby.
Yeah.
To me, it looks like a snake getting ready to bite somebody when it gets about halfway across.
It does. It looks like a snake that's going like a, I agree with you on that one. Well, I mean, I talked to clinical psychiatrists and psychologists and they say what happens is the mind is trying when your mind sees something that has never seen before. It tries to fit it into something that you have seen before. And so
that's a big thing in ghost hunting too, with pictures.
Yeah.
It's actually a thing called pareidolia. And it's where your mind tries to make sense of what it's seeing and will create something. You'll see something that will fit into what you expect to see.
Yeah.
If that makes sense to you.
No, absolutely. That perfectly. I mean, we had an experience here and everything where we had four people out and we saw something go and we all saw four different things. We're looking at your light anomaly one now.
Yeah, it's a little strange.
Oh, I see. That is all right. So here we go. Technology guy. I see the guy where it's flickering.
Okay, technology guy.
All right. So what kind of cans are those? Are those incandescent? Are they fluorescent? Did they add fluorescence inside them?
I honestly don't know.
Okay. So what?
I would give you the honest answer. I don't know.
Okay. No, that's fine. How long ago was that done?
That's probably 5 years ago.
Yeah, so they probably didn't have fluorescence. If they were incandescent, all right. So what happens with fluorescent light bulbs is they have a it's like a regulator on them. You know, the big, you know, when you buy the fluorescent, you get a big white kind of disc and stuff. That's where the voltage regulator is and some other things that are in there. I have seen those things where if they are going bad, especially if they're used over a long period of time, that they will actually trigger other, they send a signal down the electrical line, especially if they're in parallel. They'll send a signal down the electrical line and they will affect other, fluorescent light bulbs. And these are those, when I say fluorescent light bulbs, I mean the newer ones that they're trying to sell, not incandescent, not the old traditional white with the light bulb, but these are the new fluorescents that have the little.
My guess is that just having been there, and I know what those lights look like because I have them in my apartment.
Yeah.
It wasn't throwing off that kind of light.
Okay. So, yeah. That was bizarre.
My guess would be they're not fluorescent.
Yeah. That's 5 years ago.
But I don't think they are.
Yeah, if you said, well, that was done a year ago, I'd say it's probably fluorescent. But hang in there. We're going to take a quick break. We'll come back, and we'll continue the conversation with our guest, Rick of Hollywood Ghost Hunters.
Midnight Ocean with Jeff Norton on the Paranormal State Radio Network. This is the Midnight Ocean with Jeff Norton on the Paranormal State Radio Network.
That is right, Rick. Andrew. Rick would have known. He not does my voiceover work. That's Andrew. And actually, that's from Voice Crew. Great organization. If you guys need any voiceover work, get out there to voicecrew.com. They do all of our voiceover work, and they do just an outstanding job. Usually one-day turnaround. Just incredible. You can pick from a plethora of voices and everything. But right now, we are talking to our very special guest from the Hollywood Ghost Hunters, Rick. So, Rick, going back to that, you know, I looked at that video over the break, and those aren't fluorescent. Those are incandescents. They are.
Are they?
Yeah, those are incandescent. Yeah. That's bizarre. Now I'm like, wow. That is, I will throw in my, those are incandescents. And the reason being is that they come up to temperature instantly. Where the fluorescence, there's a warm-up period to them.
And you know what's funny? I don't mind, like when you said, the way you were trying to figure it out, I don't mind that at all because, while some people might say, well, you know, I found this and that's exactly what it is. Yeah. I don't mind that because the true thing of ghost hunting is debunking things. And if you can debunk it, you know, then it's not something that's worth having. But if you can't debunk it, you've tried everything you can think of and it's still there, then you're like, this might be something. Yeah. So I never mind when people say, well, this might be that, this might be that. I like the feedback.
Yeah, well, I mean, and you're right. And it lends the credibility because if you're always, you know, how do I say, one of the things that always got me about like ghost hunters is that when we see orbs, we captured orbs. And I'm like, well, that could be dust. That could be a moth. That can be, I mean, so many things that.
It's absolutely true. But you know what? In ghost hunting, there are orbs. And it's not what they're showing on TV. All that is really just the reflection of either a flash from a thing that's hitting dust that will light it up, you know. But there are actual orbs, and I've seen two in my life, that are actually that you can see with your bare eye floating. And you can see them there. I mean, and it's pretty impressive.
They have form. They manifest in some type of form, or are they?
Both of them I saw, they look like a ball.
Oh, wow.
You know, they were exactly the orb thing. One was kind of a pale blue and the other one was like a phosphorescent green.
Wow.
And, it's pretty interesting, you know, that, like I say, I've seen so many different things. And I've seen things that were obviously not paranormal, but I've had quite a few things happen to me that have just led me to say, it's out there. You know, if you go look long enough, things will happen to you.
Absolutely. I mean, I'm with you. And, you know, I had some instances here earlier, last weekend, where I was being touched and stuff like, you know, just some really... And they weren't, their intentions were not good. I mean, I just got that.
They weren't friendly.
They weren't friendly. And you know that they're here to mess with you. And
you know what's very funny that you said that?
Yeah.
Because nobody understands that when you say, oh, you just know. Yeah. And they go, well, I don't get it. But it's like when something's touching you and it has, you know, let's just say evil intent.
Yeah.
You know, instantly.
Yeah.
I mean, because, you know, we're human beings and through evolution, we have, you know, the fight or flight syndrome. And we've actually, for a long time, not only were we the predator, but we were also the prey. So we have a built-in system that will pick up when something's watching us if we would just listen to it. Because we become so advanced, you know, with all our phones and everything else that we don't pay attention to what's around us.
Yep.
You know, and my biggest thing I always tell people, if you ever have a feeling all of a sudden that someone's watching you, somebody's probably watching you.
Yeah.
And you should pay attention to it, especially if you're alone and you're walking somewhere, pay attention to it.
Yeah.
Because, you know, evolution put that in you. You need to pay attention to that.
Yep. Have you ever had one of these, an entity or anything, follow you home or come home with you?
I don't think so, but I did have one appear here in my apartment, which was the only thing that I can say that it, the instant thing I saw when I saw it, I thought demonic.
That's interesting and you say that.
And it was extraordinarily terrifying.
Yeah.
I didn't give it the, it was funny because I walked out, it was the middle of the night. I got up, I was on my computer. I had just written a scene about somebody kind of bitch slapping Satan's henchmen because I was writing a script.
Okay.
And as soon as I walked out here, this thing stood up in front of me in the dark and blocked out the light on the microwave. And I could see the shape backlit as it stood up in front of me. And it, I could feel like waves of energy hitting me.
Sure.
And you could just feel that the first thing that came to me is I thought it was a burglar when I saw it start to stand up.
Sure.
So I threw my hands up to defend myself. And this thing stood up. And I mean, it was much bigger than me. Right? And I was just standing there looking at it. And I knew that something was there because there's a microwave with a clock on it in front of me. And I can't see the clock. There's definitely something there. So I stood there for maybe 15 seconds, maybe a little longer. It's hard to tell when you're, you know, looking at something like that. And I still had my hands up, and I was thinking to myself, all I feel is this thing is trying to intimidate me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I kind of faked one direction, jumped to the other side, hit the light, and there was nothing there.
Wow.
But I don't know if it was something because of what I had written. I mean, is that possible? I mean, because it was very much, you know, anti-Satan, that all of a sudden it said, go see this guy.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, because it was like within minutes after I wrote that.
Yeah. It's interesting that you say that because I had a guest on the show not too long ago. All right. So, you know, obviously when we start doing these types of shows and everything, it's kind of like I said, the whole go back to the car thing is that you are more cognitive of what's going on around you. If you're not someone who talks about ghosts or spirits or whatever they are, you're probably not cognitive of sounds and shapes and stuff like that. You think your eyes are playing a trick on you. But once you delve into this world, my guest that I had on, John Ventry. He's a well-known UFO hunter, well-known. He's up there with Stanton Friedman, Kathleen McLean, and all of them. He's very well-known in the UFO community, and he was on the show, and I thought we were going to talk about UFOs. And he spent half the time talking about UFOs, but he goes, Jeff, he goes, I want to share something with you. He goes, Stanton and Kathleen are of the belief that a lot of the UFO, we haven't had a good abduction UFO in a long time where people have physically been abducted. It's more like people dream about it, this or that or whatever. And he said he thinks that a lot of these visions that people are having are demonic in nature. And so the show turned pretty quick and he started talking about his experiences and things that he had happened. Well, no sooner than I got off the show that night, I started to have just incredible experiences. I mean, I'm talking where I was terrified, where I'm like, this is, I actually got to the point to where I was fearful for my family. That's how bad it was. And, you know, I reached out to some guests of mine and some people that I know that are, you know, in the church and stuff. And so they gave me ways of protecting myself. But, do you have a common practice now that you do, or did you just throw on the light and it's done and you haven't had that experience again?
Well, I actually had, it started happening again, but it wasn't seeing that again.
Sure.
I started seeing shapes going through dark shadows, going through pretty much on a straight line. It took me a while to figure it out, but it's pretty much a straight line going from this wall all the way through my apartment and out into the next apartment that way.
Wow.
And the only reason it kind of caught me is because I was sitting here and one time something came out of the wall on the left side of me, scared the hell out of me. I mean, to the point I jumped. I mean, it was about the size. I used to have two big Dobermans, and it was about that size, and it was kind of oily looking and stuff, and it came out of the wall right towards my legs to the point where I just jumped out of the way. I mean, just out of reflex, and there was nothing there. And I've lived in the same apartment for going on 25 years. I know every light, every shadow you can imagine.
Yeah.
And then later that day, I walked in, I was coming out of the bathroom, and something came out of the wall about the size of a football right past my face. So I was starting to think that something was trying to actually physically attack me, because both of them, I was there. And then it kind of dawned on me. I was standing somewhere else, and I saw the shape again, and it went on the same line. I was like, am I just kind of bumbling in the way of something that's going through here? You know what I mean? That it wasn't actually after me. I was just getting in the way.
Yeah.
And there was another stunt guy that lived two apartments down from me on the same line. And he had a little five-year-old girl. They used to come over and borrow movies from me. And this was before I started the Hollywood Ghost Hunters. And never talked to anybody about ghosts or anything else. And he came up and he says, hey, can we come in and get a movie? I said, just tell me what kind you want. I'll go get it, because I didn't want the little girl coming in. I was kind of afraid for her. And he says, let me ask you something. I said, what? He goes, is your apartment haunted? I said, why do you ask that? He goes, mine is so haunted, I went and got a priest to bless it.
Yeah.
Now, this is the same line that I'm on. You know, he's the things that were coming from my apartment would have gone right into his.
Yeah.
So that was kind of interesting, getting a little bit of validation from the from the next guy without bringing it up. That was kind of interesting.
Yeah. Well.
But
And like I said, you know, I reached out to a priest front buddy of mine who's fairly. I'm trying to get him on as a guest, but we're trying to get permission. We got to get permission from the Vatican. And believe it or not, this is what's really crazy. We got to get permission from our lawyers to have him on the show, because not only do we have Vatican, but we have lawyers. This guy is a very well-known Catholic priest who does exorcisms, and there's some legal issues that we have to overcome to get him on our show.
An older gentleman?
He is an older gentleman. Yeah. And he's in Ohio.
I'm pretty sure I know who you're talking about.
Yeah, he's in Ohio. But the thing is, there's a problem. And I was like, why does the court? And they said, look, and kid you not, I'm sitting here with my attorney who doesn't believe any of this stuff. He thinks it's all bunk. He laughs, but he's my, I'm paying him money, and he's going to agree to whatever I tell him to, as long as he wants to get paid. And it was funny, because I was going through, because there are some guests that we have to get that type of clearance of what they're, to make sure we're protected legally from any kind of issues. And this one, when I was telling him about this, he was like, yeah, he goes, you gotta. And I said, why do I have to? He goes, because this guy has a history of when he's on shows, people sue the host because they get possessed, or they claim that they're possessed after listening to the shows that this guy's on. And
if you ever see somebody that you think is possessed, it's very unnerving.
Yes. Yes.
Because I believe I have seen it twice.
Yeah.
It'll send a chill up your spine for sure.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, like I said, my experience is that Sandy and I have been high school sweethearts. So we've known each other since we were best friends in high school, and then we, went our separate ways, and then we came back together, later in life. So we're like best friends, and she knows everything. When I was younger doing all the crazy stuff, she knows all the stories. She was there when I was, when I was nuts, and she went to go cover me up. And this was we did the show Thursday, and then Friday she went to go cover me up as I was sitting in a chair. And she said that she was actually fearful of her, physical. She said, because I don't remember this. She says, I looked at her, my face was contorted, and I was grunting at her like not barking, but like growling at her. And
oh, that's not a good sign.
It was not a good sign. And I will tell you, and then I had that night where I went to bed and I had, something grab my foot and pull me, like trying to pull me out of the bed. and move me. And I, you know, now I have, my house is all automated. And so I can say a command, just one word, and it turns on all the lights in the house. It's part of the system that we have. And that's what I did. And of course it went away. Well, immediately I'm on the, you know, I'm on the phone the next day and said, look, I need help. And of course, you know, got the help that I needed. I haven't had any issues since. Since
let me ask you a question.
Yeah.
This just kind of came to me out of nowhere. The night that was happening, did you look in a mirror?
No. Nope.
Because for some reason, I was just getting the feeling that you looked into a mirror and you wanted to punch the image.
No, I didn't. I didn't have. Yeah. No, I didn't. I didn't look in a mirror. I was pissed. You want to talk about pissed off? My Chicago came out in me. And you know what that means. I mean, I was like, how dare you come in my house and think you're going to do this? You got another, you know, and I was going through the house just, you know, look, you have effed with the wrong guy. And I did, I went after it. And then I got, like I said, thank God I have resources. Most people don't have that. And I shared that story, I think Monday. We talked about it the first 2 hours. I told everybody, I even did the prayer that was given to me by the priest and said, this is what you need to do. And this is what you need to, you know, you got to go do this and this. And I'm following his instructions and I haven't had any issues since. But yeah, when Sandy,
you know something, that goes kind of along with what you're talking about. I took a girl ghost hunting for a TV show called Home and Family.
Mm-hmm.
A real pretty girl who used to be on The View named Debbie Matenopoulos.
Yeah.
And, you know, we actually went ghost hunting and stuff like that. And when I was on the show, first off, I thought that I was being set up, you know, just by what happened. We're all sitting on the table, and it was Halloween. That was part of the spiel, you know, the ghost hunting for Halloween. And the host, there's Christina Farrar was one of the hosts, and I can't remember the gentleman's name, a very famous host. And he says, 58% of the people in America believe in ghosts. I don't. I was like, oh, great. Here we go.
Yeah.
And immediately, John O'Hurley, if you know who he was, used to be on Seinfeld. He was on Dancing with the Stars, the guy with the gray hair, very aristocratic looking guy.
Yeah.
And he's got a real distinctive voice. He goes, well, I know we have a ghost. My wife sees him in our house in Connecticut. She's right there. She could tell you. Yeah. And then Olivia Newton-John's sister goes, we see our grandfather all the time. Right? I'm going, aha.
Yeah.
This is going to go better than they're expecting.
Yeah.
And Christina Farrar says, my husband and I used to wake up and see a person standing in our bedroom.
Ah.
And she says, finally, it happened, you know, several times, and that she actually went out and had a priest come in and put holy water over her bedroom door.
Yeah.
Well, here's the part that got me. I asked her, I said, did you ever see him in the bedroom again? And she goes, no, but after we did that, one night my husband woke up and saw him standing looking in the window from outside.
Yeah.
Now, you know, most people wouldn't have caught that. To me, that tells me that the holy water worked and it couldn't get in.
Yeah. But it didn't.
And that
but
was
it
as
didn't
close
get,
as it could get to
it
them.
It didn't get rid of him, though.
No, but it kept them away. And they said they hadn't seen it after that.
Yeah. See,
that was interesting to me that somebody said that just the way that worked out. I was like, now that's interesting.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. No.
And by the way, you brought up Stanton Friedman.
Yeah.
One of the best nights I've ever had, I was at the Minnesota Paracon, which is one of the paranormal conventions.
Sure.
And after we were done on Sunday, you know, the Paracon was over, and I walked into the restaurant they had there. And I was going to get something to eat, and I went to the front because I wanted to charge my phone because it was almost dead. And there was a guy there who's the equivalent of Stanton Friedman, but from Canada. His name is Chris Rutkowski.
Yeah.
And I got to meet Chris. Do you know Chris?
Yep. Oh, I know of him. I don't know Chris. I'd love to get him as a guest, but I know of him. He's kind of hard to track down.
Really, really good guy. And, he comes up to me and he sees me. I'd been talking to him and I'd been talking to Stanton, you know, during breaks and what we were doing at the Paracon. And, he comes over and he goes, hey, don't sit over here eating by yourself. Come on over and sit with me and Stanton. And, there's one other person, I can't remember who it was, But anyway, we went over there and we had, for like 2 hours, we talked nothing but UFOs.
Yeah.
And which kind of surprised them because I knew what they were talking about because I'm really interested in it too. They'd say, and there was the one in England that said, oh, Rendlesham. Right. And they'd say, and then the one in Canada, Shag Harbor, you know, and they're like, oh, you know about these? I said, oh yeah, listen to all this stuff. And he told me a story. And this is the funny part. He told me what he thought happened at Roswell. Well, 2 days later, I'm back in California. I'm working on a movie for one of my best friends who's a director, and we're having lunch. And I have on my Hollywood Ghost Hunter shirt, and the guy goes, do you believe in ghosts? I said, yeah. And he goes, do you believe in UFOs? And I said, yeah. And he goes, what do you think happened at Roswell? And I said, I really think something happened there. And he goes, well, Stan Friedman says that he thinks it was shut down by the government, or shot down by the government with radar. And I said, well, that's not exactly what Stanton says. And he says, well, what do you mean? He said, well, radar back in the day used to go straight up. Correct. It didn't used to be the round, you know, when it first came out. And he says he was always under the impression that the pilots knew not to fly over the radar because it would make their equipment kind of malfunction.
Yep.
He says he always kind of wondered if one of them flew over that, and having never encountered that before, that it threw them kittywampus into the other one and they both went down. Because there were two, actually, ships, one in Corona and one in Roswell. But the guy looks at me, and there's like 25 people sitting there along with my friend, and he looks at me and he goes, what makes you think you know more what Stanton Friedman would say than I do? And I can't smile at him. I said, well, he told me when I had dinner with him Sunday night. Right? And he looked at me, and he looks over at my friend Richard, and Richard just nods his head yes, and he goes, oh, all right.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, by the way, here's his phone. I see. I get that all the time where people are like, well, and it's like, well, here's his phone. Or you want here? You can talk to him.
You know how I met Stan the first time? It was very cool. We were doing the George Norrie show down at the Queen Mary on Halloween.
That's like, right. I remember that. Ago. I remember that show actually.
And Stan was in the back in the green room, and I was there, and RA was there, the Leatherface guy.
Yeah.
And Stan looks at me and he goes, so you believe in ghosts? And I said, yes, I do. And he goes, even though there's not a shred of empirical evidence about that.
Yeah.
Right? And I looked at him, I said, you believe in UFOs? And he sat there for a second and he goes, touche.
Touche. Yeah, Stanton's one of these level. But you know what, though? Like I said, John, when we were talking, John and Stanton and Kathleen Modine and all of them, you know, John was saying it. So I think there's been a change of heart because they, and John was saying that the last Parawine that they did, they just came back from it and they were talking about how, like I said, how there hasn't been a good abduction story in the last 3 or 4 years. And they think that the physical abductions are done with and that what most people are experiencing. Now, I don't know if Stanton agreed with it or was this John making a statement, but he was like, most of the stuff that people are thinking there, John is like, I'm thinking that this is more demonic in nature and not actual, you know, UFO abduction, physical abduction. And,
I don't know Stanton well enough to speak for him.
Yeah.
But I do know that in the discussion we had that night, that never came up.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, that's several years ago. So this may be something, you know, else that he's come across.
He might have progressed into this. Yep. Yeah. But Stan's a really great guy.
I can't speak for him.
Yeah. Yeah. I wouldn't either.
He's a really nice guy. So is Rutkowski.
Yeah.
And both of them would be great guests for you.
Well, Stan's been on the show. Like I said, he's been on the show. We've been in communication. It's funny. My cell phone is a, how do I say this? If you got any problems in the paranormal world, let me know. I'll give you a phone number. I've got pretty much I got guys who haven't been on the show that can't come on the show because of contractual obligations or stuff like that. But I still got their phone numbers. I still talk to them and say, hey, look, you know, what would you recommend that I do in this case? It's amazing. And for the most part, you know, these people are willing to help you. But I was always wondering about that. If you have ever had an entity come home with you, and then how did you deal with it and stuff?
No, I never had one. But like I said, this one appeared.
Yeah.
And there was more to that story that I was telling you. After that, I started having white shadows go through my apartment.
Sure.
Which, you know, I was trying logically to figure it out, and I figured out that maybe the dark ones were the bad guys, and maybe the white ones were good guys. You know, because I'd never seen it before. Yeah. I haven't seen it since. But Here's a weird thing. These two twin girls came over who were obsessed with trying to contact their dad, right, who had passed like 2 years before.
Sure.
So I got out the spirit box, and they grabbed pen and paper, and they sat down. And like I said, the spirit box never says a word. I mean, it'll say something very seldom.
Hey, Rick.
Well,
I hate that,
yeah,
because
you got
I want
a break coming up.
We got a break, so I want to hear this in its entirety without any interruptions. Now, I will tell you, after this break, we can go all night without taking breaks. So it's the first 2 hours, and then let's take a break. We'll come back. I want to hear this story. This is fascinating stuff. Yeah, guys out there in the chat room, don't worry about us. I appreciate your concern and everything. I really do, and thank you. And I trust me, I do. I do appreciate your concern, but I am in good hands. I'm sure Rick is too. And I will tell you, things have gotten tremendously better around the Norton household since I started listening to those that know. But you're listening to the Midnight Ocean Radio Show and a podcast. We're going to take a quick 4 minute break. We're going to come back, talk with our guest, Rick McCallum, who is co-founder of Hollywood Ghost
this
Hunters.
This is the Midnight Ocean with Jeff Norton on the Paranormal State Radio Network. Jeff Norton on the Paranormal State Radio Network.
You are right, Andrew. This is the Midnight Ocean Radio Show and a podcast. We're talking with the co-founder, Rick McCallum. And right before the show, we're getting off on a little bit of a tangent, but I think it's all one in the same, Rick. I think these are valid concerns any ghost hunter would have. I know most people think, oh, we're going to talk about all your experiences and stuff, but I think, you know, as you brought up, you're starting to see white figures now move across the...
Not figures, just shadows.
Just shadows, white shadows. Wow.
Yeah, so the girls are listening to the spirit box, and like I said, it doesn't say things very often.
Sure.
And this thing starts chattering one word after another for about a half an hour. I went into my bedroom and I was on the computer and I could hear, and they're writing down and writing down and writing down. And I came out and finally I said, hey girls, you know, you got like five pages of stuff you've been written. What are you trying to accomplish here?
Yeah.
And they said, you know, they were looking for their father and stuff like that. Well, then it says father and then the last name of their last name. You know, and they're still just writing. And I said, girls, look at what you just wrote. And then all of a sudden they're all excited. But I said, look, I want, as long as it's answering this, actually it's so active, let me ask something. I said, what are all these white shapes? And it said something like macaroni or something, made no sense. And I said, no, I really want to know what these white shapes are. And it said, scent protection.
Oh.
And I said, I started to say something, and one of the girls goes, well, are you good or are you bad? And it says loving. And I was like,
good for you.
I think I got some backup here.
Yeah.
Right?
Good for you.
So that night, after the girls left, I walked back into my bedroom, and I was coming out, the same thing, going to get a drink of water late at night. And as I got almost to my door, I heard a voice inside my head go, he's here, which, you know, made me go, oh,
yeah,
that thing's back. You know, yeah. I knew exactly what I was talking about. That's back.
Yeah.
So I did exactly what you did. I walked out, and I just said, all right, you son of so and yeah, you know, you want to get to it? Show up.
Yep.
You know, and I said, because, you know, you miserable coward, you know I'm not alone.
Yeah.
You know, and nothing showed up. I've never had another thing happen in here, ever. Never seen another shadow.
Yeah.
You know, so I found that to be very interesting.
Yeah. Well, you know, I do not recommend anybody confront these entities unless you have knowledge and stuff. And like I said, I'll shoot over to you. I don't know what your belief system is. And this was a prayer that was given to me by the exorcist, by, you know, my priest friend who's an exorcist. And he said, say this prayer. And, you know, if these issues are happening, this is the prayer you say. And it was amazing though. I can tell you. It was terrifying. I've never been that. And you're talking to a guy who's seen some pretty terrific, you know, horrific things in his life. And I ain't never been that terrified as I was.
Yeah. It's when all of a sudden, when you're confronted with something that is beyond what you, you know, generally believe or can really conceive, all of a sudden you're like, ah,
yeah. You know? And evil. And you can sense that it is not there for your well-being, for your, you know, you know, for you, it is there. Well, it's exactly. There for you, but you know, it wants you to want to consume you. And
well, what was funny to me, not funny, but odd, was when you said you started growling, and I said, that's not good.
Yeah.
Because most people believe when you hear growling sounds that it is something demonic.
Yep.
And in my ghost hunting career, I have actually experienced growling next to me five different times.
Mm.
And both, I mean, in all of these times, there was other people there that also heard it. So it wasn't like I have a brain aneurysm or, you know, anything like that, or wild imagination. The other people also heard it.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's just weird when, you know, you're walking by yourself and something growls near you and there's nothing there.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, it's...
Yeah, I mean, no, that's a good indication. You know, growling. I think of that famous line, you know, from Ghostbusters. Well, she sleeps above the covers, and they're like, "Well, that's normal." No, no, 5 feet above the covers. You know, that's a great line.
But have you ever heard of Rosalind Chapel?
Oh, absolutely. Actually, I have. I was telling you know, I have a professor who is going over there. He's doing a lecture in Edinburgh, and he's going to try to get over to Rosalind Chapel to take some pictures for me, because out of my research, but go ahead. I'll let, yeah, absolutely know about Roslyn Chapel.
Well, I'm going to disappoint you right off the bat. They won't let you take pictures of the chapel.
That's what that's what they said, but okay. How do I say this? He's a musician now, and you can confirm or deny this, but inside Roslyn Chapel, apparently there is the, what they call the devil song or the incantation song. And
yeah,
my professor friend is also a musician. He's a very, very good musician. And so I'm sending him over there as a musician because to see if he can get the song off of the plates. Are you familiar? You know what I'm talking about?
I don't know the song. No.
Yeah. Well, most people don't. Yeah. Apparently you can't take pictures. You're right. But there is apparently on one of the far walls, John Ventre was telling me this, that in Roslyn Chapel on the far wall, there is the devil, what they call the devil's chord or the devil's song, which supposedly is the song or the chord, you know, to raise and control spirits. And
I did not see that while I was there. Mm-hmm. I've actually been in there. I've stayed when I go there. I always stay in this little inn that's right across the street.
Yeah.
And I've been there so much. I mean, I walk in and they go, "Hi, Rick," you know. But it's actually a fascinating place. I mean, it's truly fascinating. But I was walking out of there one night. Now, it was still daytime, but it was just starting to get dark. And there were two older ladies ahead of me. And I walked by them. And on the left side, as I'm walking out, there's the original Roslyn Inn, which is from the 1500s.
Mm-hmm.
And I was looking at that. And there's a walkway probably 10 yards wide, and it's about 200 yards straight all the way, and it goes right to the little inn where I was staying. There's a little village right there.
Sure.
And I'm walking along, go by the little old ladies, and I'm looking over the thing, and right in front of me, and I would say maybe 8 to 10 feet away, something growled. It sounded like, the only way of saying it sounded demonic and nastiest growl, loud. I mean, like, right? And I froze. Right, because I was looking off to the side, and I was sure that there was a guard dog right in front of me going to tear me to shreds. So I stopped and stood completely still, and I turned my head around, and there's nothing there. Nothing anywhere around, nothing ahead, you know, there's nothing there, right? And I'm standing there, and I'm looking around, and the two ladies walked up behind me, and they went, "We heard it too." So, I mean, it's just, it's weird. I've had the fifth time that happened, and that one just scared the living tar out of me.
Wow.
I mean, it was so loud and so nasty. It sounded almost like a grizzly bear or something. It was so, yeah.
Yeah. No, and a lot of people, like I said, until it happens to you, you don't understand. You really don't. I mean, when I was young, when my first wife, we lived in a small house that was, in the middle of nowhere in Tennessee, and I had woke up with a figure standing looking at the bed, and I was out that, you know, the next day. We were going through a divorce, and I was staying in this old farmhouse by myself, and then come to find out, the farmhouse was the scene of one of the most, well, this is after we moved out. But I always thought that place was haunted. I always had a weird feeling, had an upstairs. We never went upstairs. It was one of these things where you always think someone was up there or presence was up there. So we never went upstairs, never went upstairs, especially at night. I think a couple times I would go.
That's the first place I would have gone. If I get a feeling something's there, I go look.
Well, I was young and naive. Now I will tell you, during the day, I used to shoot pistols for competition. So I had a little an air pistol range set up upstairs because there was two bedrooms up there, and I'd open up the door to both bedrooms and we would go up there and shoot, you know, our little air guns, the practice for shooting real guns. And, I would do that during the day, but not at night. I wouldn't do it. I wouldn't mess around with it at night. And, I Laura used to get mad at me because the lights would be, you know, I'd go to work. This was when I was going to college and paying and working at the hospital at night. And she would yell at me because I would leave the lights on for her and stuff. She was like, "Why, you know, I'm okay." And I'm like, "Laura, I didn't leave the lights on for you. But she would get up in the middle of the night, you know, to go to the bathroom in the back of the house and all the lights were on or the TV was on or something, you know. And so when she moved out, when we separated, she moved out, I woke up to a figure standing over the bed. And then come to find out, he was actually standing on Lori's side of the bed and he was looking, he was sad. And I thought it was a police officer. And then when I put my glasses on and everything, I realized that it was not a real person. It was an entity. And I said, boom, I'm gone. And 2 days later, I threw everything I owned in the back of my truck and I was gone. And I, you know.
You know, it's funny. That's a pretty standard story, though.
Yeah.
Not about, the, I mean, with the lights being turned on and yeah. You know, figure that's, they're just trying to tell you they're there.
They're there. Well, and I'm a firm believer because when I re-described this individual, because it was, I thought it was a police officer, but it was weird because it was a police officer that was wearing, like the old bloomer boots, you know, the high boots and the, and I looked at old pictures of the law enforcement come to find out the guy that owned the house before us was the old police chief of the town who died in the house. So that kind of confirmed
that's pretty
it.
Cool.
Yeah. I mean, that I was cool with, I was like, oh, okay, that's cool. You know, I wasn't freaked out about that at all. So then the thing was, is that my daughter who still lives there in with her mother, we were talking a couple years ago, my daughter calls me. And she's like, hey, Dad. And I'm like, what? She goes, you know that house that you and Mom lived in? I'm like, yeah. Well, you know, there was a murder there. And I'm like, what? And she goes, yeah, the people that were living there, apparently the wife hired a hitman. The husband came home and they chopped him up. And they, you know, it was like the most gruesome thing. And they're claiming that the devil made him do it. And I was like, yeah, look, I mean, people will claim whatever. But I will tell you, the upstairs of that house, you just had a weird feeling about that. You just did not want to go up there. And what was also strange, no one lived up there, even when the police chief, because he lived in the master bedroom, which was downstairs. The upstairs was like an attic kind of converted. And you could tell that no one has been up there for, you know, 50, 60 years at least. It was that, not decrepit, but that. You know, you could just tell that they never used those rooms. And I never know the history of those rooms.
I mean, it's always amazing to me when you actually find out after the fact that what you had seen is, you know, has some value to it, you know?
Yeah.
I will tell you one of the funniest things, scary-wise, didn't happen to me, actually happened to one of my guys when we were at the place where you were showing the things in the hallway and the lights going off. We were all the way down in the basement, and in that hallway that you can see there, we heard, and there was a bunch of us downstairs, a guy named Chris Moon, who used to have Haunted Times magazine, and he was there with his, Frank's box, and we were using that. And we heard real heavy footsteps. I mean, real heavy. I mean, to the point that we could hear them very easily over everybody talking. And Robert was standing there. Now, Robert's, you know, 6'5", 320. He's a big, scary-looking dude. Looks like Penn from Penn & Teller.
Yeah.
And he's standing right there, and he sees it, and he goes upstairs, you know, to see what's going on. So we're all still down there, and he comes walking back down, and it's a spiral staircase. As soon as he gets to the bottom, it was so weird. It sounded like somebody was jumping with both feet and stomping as hard as they could on the ceiling, going all the way down the hallway. I mean, it was like, boom, boom, boom. I mean, super loud. So Robert goes scooting up. I took off and I went up after him and we both went through the entire upstairs. There wasn't a single person. We looked in closets, under beds, everything. Nobody was up there. But Robert comes up to me and he goes, yeah, I got to tell you what happened. And I said, what? He goes, I got up there the first time. And when I got up there, I could hear the footsteps going away down the hallway towards where you saw what you thought was something manifesting. And he says, I walked that way all the way up to the doorway. That's actually a laundry room. He says, and I stood there and I was looking in there. And then I heard the footsteps rush up behind me. And I was like, oh, now that's creepy. Yeah. I've never heard of it, you know, following them one place and then they run up from behind you.
Yeah. Well, in the booming, I got to ask this question because this is actually somewhat important with my experience. The booming, when you did it, was it three? Was it usually in series of threes?
No, this was something that was making a point of going down the entire hallway. Okay.
Yeah, because one of the experiences I had is that I would, when, you know, prior to, I would wake up or I would hear like someone knocking or pounding on my wall, outside wall, you know, three times. And I was told by John, he's like, well, that's them messing with you. And sure enough, and that was, it was a distinctive boom, boom, boom. And it's woken me up. Now, you know, because I do the show late at night during the week, I sleep in the guest bedroom so I don't wake Sandy up, you know, at 2-3 o'clock in the morning. Plus we have dogs, and if I go in there and wake them up, they're up all night. And then unfortunately Sandy's up at 4 o'clock in the morning to take care of dogs and stuff. So the thing is I sleep in a separate bedroom, and it was so distinctive that I thought maybe there's been times where Sandy's gone out and work in the yard or whatever in the morning while I'm still asleep, and she's locked herself out, and she'll come and knock on the window or whatever, you know, to let herself back in. But no, these were solid boom, 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 you know, pounding on the walls, and, you know, to the point that it wakes me up. And it's just, like I said, it was uncanny, but I haven't had those experiences since I.
Yeah, that's something trying to tell you it's there.
Yeah. Yeah. And this, but unfortunately, that's not a good, you know, these entities are not the good ones. These are the bad ones.
Yeah.
That are saying, hello, wake up. Yeah.
Well, I will tell you one that we got one time on tape, an EVP that we got on tape, was at a place called the Houdini House, which is actually not Houdini's house. It's just what they call it because, you know, he'd been there. Me and Ed, who's like my size, he and I were both down in this one basement, and we walked by this one, going into the one room, this huge black shadow went across the wall. So I said, Ed, I just saw a huge shadow. So he and I both together walked the same way, going back and forth, in and out of the door over and over again. We couldn't cast any shadow at all.
Yeah.
So there's like no outside light that could come in because it's on a hill. You know, there's nothing that would come in. So we go in there, and there's two twin beds. And I go over to the far one, and I set down the K2 meter that has the five lights and the voice recorder. And I go over and I sit down about 10 feet away on a futon, and Ed picks up the K2 meter and says, I'm going to get a bass reading, and starts walking into the bathroom. Well, I listened to the recording a long time after that. You hear Ed say, I'm going to get a bass reading, and then you hear right into the recorder, which is on the bed, no. I mean, very distinct. Well, when I was over in Scotland, I was at Roslyn Chapel with another group, and we were out by the castle, you know, at night. It was like maybe midnight. We were out walking through the forest there trying to find other stuff. And I said, listen to this one. And he goes, wow, that's really something. I said, yeah, the no is really, he says, no, what it says right before that. And I said, what? And he goes, yeah, it says something right before that. So I listened, I said, yeah, I can kind of hear something. He goes, you want to know what it says? And I said, yeah, tell me what you think. So he told me. So I came back here, and I was able to put it in the audio software and bump it up so it was loud enough. And sure enough, it says what he says, you know, he heard it.
Yeah.
And what it says is, as Ed is walking away, it goes, get back here, punk. And then it goes, no! Huh. So, I mean, that's a pretty interesting one. I mean, that one was somebody with some attitude.
Now, did it have a, like, did it have an accent or anything, or was it?
No, it just sounded
English?
Perturbed.
Perturbed to someone, but you couldn't tell, like, an accent or anything? Like,
no, it didn't really, because it was just like, it sounds just like this. It's like, get back here, punk.
And then,
There's no English accent. There's nothing like that.
Sure. You know, I was always wondering, you know, especially like with ghosts and stuff, is that, you know, has anybody gotten EVPs in foreign languages?
I would imagine that is the case. But I will tell you something that goes along with the kind of answer the question you're having. The ghost adventures that Kane and R.A. and I were on was at a place called the Pico House, which was the old, where the governor of California, Pio Pico, lived. Mm-hmm. And we did the ghost hunt there. Well, the reason it's supposed to be haunted is that there was a big race riot out there between the Chinese and the a lot of the Mexican people that lived in the neighborhood and the white people, because the Chinese people were coming in with the tong and just terrorizing everybody. Sure. And they actually killed the Irish cop that was on the beat. And all the people turned against him, and there was a big riot. And evidently, 17 people got killed in the riot right on that property. Well, after we were there, I got a call from a lady, asked us if we could come down and ghost hunt with their group. And I said, sure, why not? So we got down there, and we're walking through there, and we're trying to get, you know, responses on the K2 and whatnot, and nothing's happening. And it dawned on me all of a sudden. I turned around and I said, does anybody here speak Spanish? And this girl goes, I do. I said, repeat what I say in Spanish. So as soon as she started saying things in Spanish, the K2 meter started lighting up.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that kind of tells me that the spirits were speaking another language.
Yeah. And, you know, that was the one thing I've always wondered, because everything seems to be, well, in English or whatever, but I think it would be incredible to get,
well,
you know, EVPs that are in other languages. And
well, I have seen that on television. I haven't had it happen to me. I have seen, where was it? It wasn't Dracula's castle. It was some famous castle in Europe. And they got a bunch of voices on there, but they didn't know what it was saying. And they went to the guy that lived there, and he goes, it's German. And he says, what is it saying? And he told them, you know, what the voice was saying.
Cool.
So it was a German region. So that makes sense that it would be in German.
So if you could, how do I say, I mean, what in all of your ventures, what's the most haunted? What's the most haunted place you've ever been to?
There's a toss up. There's several. Sloss Furnace in Alabama is very haunted.
So what is Sloss Furnace?
It's actually a place where they used to make the furnace, you know, smelt the metal.
Sure.
For like World War One and World War II. And it's actually where a famous saying, the slag heap, came from, because these furnaces were like, you know, thousands of degrees, and if you walked too close to it, the outside of it, you'd vaporize. I mean, that's how hot some of these things were. But they said that at one time, this is what I was told, you know, may not all be exactly what happened, but what I was told was they said that this one guy, his name was Slag, ran the night shift, and he pushed the guys so hard that they were having guys dying at a very rapid rate. So they said one night he went up to the top to check the furnace, and he fell in. Mm. Well, there's some conjecture that he might have fallen in with a whole bunch of people helping him, you know?
Yeah.
That happened or not, I don't know. But after that, at the bottom of the furnace, there are little pieces of molten metal that will fall out on the bottom, and when they get cool, they throw them on a heap.
Sure.
And it started coming out, and they go, oh, another piece of slag. So that's where it ended up being. The slag heap was from Sloss Furnace.
Gotcha.
But that place has got some major stuff going on. The Omen House, which is the house with that hallway, has a lot of stuff happen there. When we got there, when we first walked in, David Omen was showing us around, and walked in there, and as soon as we walked in, we went to the right, which is a little corridor that goes to a bathroom. And I stopped and I said, dude, there's something right here in front of the bathroom. I said, there's this energy right here. And he goes, oh, James von Prague was here and another guy was here. And they say that there's a portal in the bathroom. And I said, well, it's right here, not in the bathroom. It's right here. So Robert goes out and he takes three pictures, one to the left of the bathroom, which is an aquarium with all these little things fall over all the time. Then one of right where the bathroom was, and then one of the kitchen. And in the three pictures, the first one is perfectly clear, the second one is completely oranged out, and the third one is completely clear.
Hmm.
So, the picture that he took towards where, you know, they think is a portal was totally oranged out.
It was oranged out. Wow.
Yeah, so there's some sort of energy, something coming through there.
Now, when he took, was this a digital camera that he took it with, or was it a Kodak, or what kind of camera?
No, it was digital.
Digital. Hmm. Yeah. That is crazy. And so
there wouldn't be any emulsion or anything like that to to think of. I mean, it's he took them 1, 2, 3, you know, click, click, sure, click from the same spot. So that was pretty interesting. But wow, there's a lot of weird stuff happens there. The Pioneer Saloon that I just went to, I mean, with those voices that they caught, that's, yeah, you know, release him, turn Rick back. You know, I don't think the spirits like me. We do, yeah, you know. That's, you know, and then I heard my name at least twice. And you know what? A little follow-up on that. The girl called me the next day, and she goes, you know, after you left, we heard your name called 2 more times. And then I called her about a week later saying, you know, I want to come back. Yeah. And she goes, you know what? We heard your name 2 more times the next night.
You have so fans, Rick.
Something there wants to talk to me, and I want to go back and find out what it is.
Sure. Sure.
You know?
Now, I've kind of heard you allude to this a couple of times. Are you clairvoyant? Do you have abilities?
I wouldn't say I do. No. But I do. I would say if, you know, you're trying to peg me into anything that people say, it would be kind of sensitive to things.
Okay.
You know, and every once in a while I get a feeling that I kind of, like with you, you know, because I was picking up the anger that you were talking about. You know, before you said you were really angry, and I just, for some reason, just saw you like taking a swing at the mirror when you saw your picture.
Yeah.
You know, but you know, like it's like I said, I think I was picking up on how angry you got while what was going on.
Yeah.
But I mean, things like that happen to me sometimes. I mean, okay, I'll tell you something that's really weird. I have a where I've seen this while I've been awake several times, sitting right in this chair where I'm sitting across from my TV. I see, and I don't know if it's not a vision or something like that. It's more something that's just in my subconscious that I see. And I see the wall across from me roll up, and I feel my chair start to turn sideways. And it's like a wave. You know how a wave, wow, would come up and crash over you?
Yeah, yeah.
And I see it go up, and I feel my chair turn sideways, which tells me the building is tipping over. You know, and I've had this, seen this multiple times. Now, whether it's just me imagining things, you know, but the fact that I do live, I did go through a really big earthquake in here, nothing like to that magnitude, but,
yeah,
you know, it's funny that I keep having that same thing.
When does that start? I mean, did it start recently or?
No, it's been the last 10 years, I'd say.
Wow.
And I've probably had it maybe 4 times.
Is it on the same wall that these entities go flying through? On the same line?
No.
Okay.
No.
So it's on a different
wall? Not at all.
Okay.
Yeah. It's actually by my front door and the big window that's right there, you know, that looks out to the pool.
Yeah.
And why it's there and it's not behind me or over to the other side or anything else, but it's always there.
Hmm.
So I don't know. Maybe I just got a thought stuck in my head and I'm dreaming it up. That's very possible too. I've got a good imagination. You know, who knows?
Yeah. Well, I was going to tell you one of the things that was shared with me, and you go back to where you're writing that your screenplay, and then you saw the entity stand up. Is that it was shared with me that when you look at them, they start looking at you. So when you start,
I believe if you call them out, they show up.
Yeah, yeah. So a lot of it is your own self doing, right? I mean, it's because I never had these experiences until I started to do this show myself, and so.
Well, this wasn't so much intentional. It wasn't like I was calling them out. I was writing something.
Yeah.
You know, I was writing a script, but I think something answered me. I mean,
yeah,
the only thing I can think of is all of a sudden there's something standing there.
Yeah.
And I mean, just the fact that it was just moments before that I wrote this.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, was highly coincidental.
Yeah. No, I mean, like I said, and that's always been a concern. And for some reason, because, you know, you talked about that, you know, at the jail cell and stuff, and, you know, and I'll tell people this because I think we need to be on. We were talking earlier today when I called you, Rick, to, you know, confirm the show and stuff. And I was telling you about some of the plans that I have and about, and for those that are listening new to the show and stuff, you know, my goal is to travel this country, not just the country, but to do radio shows from remote locations. But the other part of that is to go to highly known haunted places, and one of them is the prison in Ohio, and the other ones, there's a bar there, and lock myself or have myself locked in overnight by myself. Do the show live, have experts who have been there and, you know, on the show as guests, but calling in or work talking to them, but be hooked up to scientific EEGs and brain scan equipment and EKGs, and then also set the cameras up and stuff and do a show and see if I can capture something myself. And it's kind of, you know, making me a little nervous where you mentioned the prison that you were at and you guys saw that dark entity. I know Ghost Hunter saw the dark entity there in that cell as well. And, you know, now I'm getting a little freaked out about this. You know, it's like, maybe this is not a good idea.
I wouldn't be worried about it. I will tell you, though, just a cautionary tale.
Sure.
When I took Debbie Matenopoulos out to a place called the Graber Olive House for the ghost hunting, the Home and Family show, we were getting responses on the K2 meter, all five lights, which is extraordinarily rare and is very strong. And it was kind of funny. It was almost like the spirit had the hots for Debbie. Right? It was really kind of funny. And she said something, and she goes, "Oh, I love you. Do you want to go with me?" And I went, hold it.
Yeah.
Right? I said, don't ever say that. Yeah. I said, because if you ask them to come with you, they will.
Yes.
Right? So I said on screen, I said, all right, now I want you to pay attention to me. Debbie's going home. You're staying here.
Yes.
Do you understand that? And it goes all five lights again. And she goes, oh, she goes, isn't he, you know, or something. He's so sweet. And I was like, okay.
Yeah. As I say, I mean, well, we're going to do precautions. I mean, outside, I'm going to have, I have a real good friend who's a mystic, a channeler and stuff. And then we're going to arrange to have, hopefully, my buddy who's the exorcist, so we can do, you know, I'm going to, of course, do confession before, do all the good Catholic things and do the confession and do all of that and sit down with a priest and then do the show. Yeah, I mean, I'm taking it seriously. It's kind of like a stuntman.
Well, a lot of people do.
Yeah, go ahead.
A lot of ghost hunters believe that this helps is when you're getting ready to leave.
Yeah.
You just say, look, you are not allowed to go with me.
Sure.
This is your place. I'm going to my place. You are not allowed to follow me.
Yeah.
And that seems to protect quite a few people.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, the people that do that seem not to have any issues.
Any issues afterwards.
But, you know, the problem with ghost hunting, you know, there is no, you know, total answer. I mean, it's conjecture, you know, most of it.
Yeah.
It's one person's opinion of what they're seeing. You know, I could see something and think it's a spirit. Somebody else could see it and not see anything at all. You know, so it's being in the paranormal field is kind of fascinating, and it's kind of frustrating at the same time.
Well, yeah, there's no manual. There is no book.
Yeah.
But there, you know, there's no book for life, right? Except the Bible, you know, if you read the Bible. But that, you know, my point is that there is no instruction manual. How do you deal with these things? I mean, everybody has a belief.
Well, it was funny. I told them, they asked me, they said, well, what exactly is this? And I said, you're looking at it. Mm-hmm. You know, your guess is as good as mine. And they said, well, what do you think happens when you die? And I said, well, that's a good question too. I said, as far as I know, I've never had the
experience.
Never been dead before, so I can't really tell you.
Yeah.
I said, you know, so.
Yeah, no, you're right. I mean, you are dealing with the unknown, and you got to go and read, you know, I've read some Crowley and stuff like that for the occult and to understand what you're dealing with and stuff. But there is no how-to manual for this stuff. I mean, it is all by, and it's dangerous, but you got to, like, in, you know, in your real life profession, you prepare, you have certain safety guidelines, certain things you do. And, you know, just like, I'm going to do the same thing. I'm going to follow through. And I mean, just to tell you how divided it is, I tell people that I'm in contact with a known Catholic priest, this is what he does, and he's very well known for this. And they're like, oh, that's the worst thing you can do. You know, let's talk to a Catholic priest. You know, like I said, everybody has an opinion, and I also say what works for me might not work for you or whatever, but it's,
well, you know what, I happen to be Catholic myself, yeah. But one of my feelings about religion, yeah, is I never understand why people fight over religion.
Yeah.
Because the basis of every religion is there is one God.
Correct.
Now, no matter what you call them, aren't we all talking to the same person?
Yes. Yeah. Well, see, for me, that answer, to answer your question, yeah. And for me, when I ask that question, like, I always get thrown back to Abraham. When he, you know, was Abraham and Sarah tried to have kids, they couldn't. Abraham got his maidservant pregnant with his child. Then Sarah got pregnant. You know, then Abraham casted his maidservant off with a child. Abraham was distraught, and God clearly came back to him and said, don't you worry about them. I'll take care of them. Which to me is the message that, hey, look, there are going to be different beliefs, different, you know, and of course, if you follow that story, that's what the Muslim religion came out of that. And, you know, but that to me says God is even saying, look, there's different things. There's going to be different beliefs. Don't you get caught up in all that junk. You worry about what you need to worry about and let me worry about everything else. And so that's
how the only thing I worry about is that Heather Locklear won't return my calls.
Hey, you talk about Heather Locklear. Here in Florida, I drive by it every week. Well, when we go see my in-laws, it's this is really bad, but I make the comment, Farrah Fawcett's old house here on Ormond Beach in Florida, and it's been up for sale now for over 10 years. This house, I mean, ever since she's passed. I think it was up for sale before she passed. And you know, unfortunately, people will book just to go in there and look at it. And I always said, I'd buy the house as long as she came with it, I'd buy it.
Yeah. Well, I mean, every guy that actually liked girls.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, back in that day, I mean, Farrah Fawcett was it.
Yeah, she was it. Yeah.
I mean, she was it. It was like every guy, you know, that I knew was like, oh, Farrah.
Yeah, I mean, well, every guy had the poster, right? The poster of her on the wall. That was the poster.
Still have that poster.
Yeah? That's funny.
Mm-hmm.
I
have it on my wall. It was in my house in Chicago. It's been buried for 30-some years.
That's funny.
And I just happened to find that, an Elvis poster and a Farrah poster.
That's funny. You know, yeah, we were never allowed to have it, but we'd go to our friend's house who had it, and I remember going, ooh, Farrah. You know, and the poster. But like I said, we drive by our house, and that's still up for sale. And it's funny because my in-laws are like, maybe it's haunted. I'm like, hey, if it's haunted, I'm buying it. I mean, come on. If you're going to get haunted by something, you know, Farrah Fawcett's not a bad thing to get haunted by.
I mean, think about this. You wake up and Farrah's standing at the end of your bed.
Yeah, I mean,
how terrifying is that?
How terrifying. Yeah, even though you can see through her or whatever.
Yeah, I mean, how terrifying would that be? I mean, yeah,
it's still Farrah Fawcett. So, you know, you don't want to mess with that stuff. I mean, we joke about it. We kid.
No. Bless her heart. She was a class act.
Yes.
Died with dignity, and I hope she's resting in peace.
Yeah, yeah. No, that's it. I mean, have you, in your investigation, have you ever, like, when you do stunts, have you ever gotten into one where you just said, what the heck am I doing? Why am I doing this?
No, well, yeah.
Yeah. What was I thinking? Why did I leave the house?
Quite a bit of times.
Then why do you do it then?
Well, you got to know my motto.
Okay.
Yeah, my motto is if you're not living on the edge, you're taking up too much space.
Ah, so yes, obviously you are a adrenaline junkie.
No, not really.
Oh, really?
I just like doing things that other people won't do.
Ah.
Like, there was a movie we did called Darkwolf.
Sure.
And the premise of it was the last Darkwolf. It was like a werewolf human hybrid. But they would turn into a wolf, a four-legged wolf, which I played, which is, you talk about trying to run on fall, you know, with arm extensions and run and lay. But anyway, Kane played the human part. I played the werewolf part. And there is a scene in there at the end where I run and I jump on the hood of a car, and it takes off going backwards. You know, I'm smashing the windows and, you know, trying to get in. And it does a reverse 90 going about 20, maybe even faster, miles an hour. And you remember when you used to play Crack the Whip?
Yeah.
Did you ever play that? You know, where you'd run and you'd, you know, sling the other person.
Yeah.
That's what this is like. Anyway, I'm up on the hood and we have two 55-gallon drum lines set up, two deep and two high. So in other words, there's, you know, two walls of 55-gallon drums.
Sure.
And there's one on top of each other. So they're real thick. And I'm on there and that thing whips me off there and I go head first into the barrels. And when I went in there, you know, I got hit. And the one thing you need to have is your air awareness. You have to know where you are so you know how to land. And I went up in the air and I hit head first into the first barrel, took out the second barrel with my side. Another barrel flung around. They started flying like bowling pins when I went through. Something else hit me and I went a different direction. I had no clue where I was. All I could see was, if you imagine, you know, you were falling down the stairs and you're trying to figure out where you're at and all you see is everything moving.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I'm getting hit from barrels all different directions and I flipped up in the air and I came down on my back on the edge of one of the barrels and it kicked me out and I landed on my stomach on the other side. But I was like, as I was going through that, I was like, what the hell was I thinking with that?
Well, you ask yourself, am I getting paid enough for this? Am I really?
Well, no, I was laying there. I was laying there on the ground, and I mean, it rung my bell because I mean, when you hit a steel barrel with your head, you know, one of the barrels flew up and hit me right in the ear, and I could feel the blood coming out of my ear. So I'm laying on my back because I had to lay still so they wouldn't see me in the shot as the car rode away. So I'm laying on flat on my back, and they yell cut, and Robert, you know, one of my guys, comes over and he goes, hold still. I got to take the helmet off. It's not really a helmet. It's a mask, right?
Yeah.
And he's pulling it off of my head and I'm laying there. And my friend Richard runs over and he goes, are you okay? And I said, well, I'm up to my waist so far, so good.
Yeah.
You know, taking inventory. Yeah. And they pull the thing off and there's blood coming out of my ear. So all of a sudden they all think that I've got some sort of, you know, brain injury or something. And they said, oh, you got to go, you know, go to hospital. I said, I don't have to go to hospital. I said, there's a cut inside my ear. I felt the barrel hit me in the ear. Yeah. So they looked in and the inside of my ear was cut. So that was okay. But my lower back had a black spot on it for like 2 weeks, about the size of a football, from where I came down and landed right on the edge of the thing and got tossed forward. But, you know, I will tell you, the stunt business is a dangerous business.
Yeah.
I mean, you cut out all the stuff that you can do, but things do, you know, you have to plan for the unplanned is the real secret to anything.
Yeah.
So.
You got to prepare for it. You know, talking about stunt stuff, I was watching, you know, I was reading, you know, you did work on the Devil's Reject, right? As well. We're going to switch gear.
I actually doubled for Captain Spaulding.
Oh, okay. So there you go. Rob Zombie?
I was in the final scene in the car when it's racing down there and shooting at the bad guys.
Shooting at them?
Shooting.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I guess my question is this. Is Rob Zombie seems like a really cool cat. I want to say, because everybody, I know he has a public persona about himself, and like most people, I'm sure he probably has a private persona, or the two with him, are they one and the same? You know, Rob is Rob.
Well, I can tell you, I had absolutely the most minimal amount of interaction with Rob.
Yeah.
When I got there, there was a girl that was doubling for Sherry Moon, and myself doubling for him, for Captain Spaulding. And the first AD took us over, and Rob was up, standing up a little higher up on a hill. And he looked, he said, these are the doubles. And he looked, and he just nodded his head.
Okay.
Right? And off we went. So that was really the only thing, because he didn't direct the last scene. I think it was an AD, because he was directing something else off over there, or he might have come when I wasn't paying attention.
Oh, gotcha.
Because we were kind of busy in the car doing what we were doing.
Sure.
So, and they were on the walkie-talkie saying, you go. So he may have been there. But that was the extent of my, you know, I couldn't give you a good answer about Rob, because I really didn't get a chance to meet him or talk to him.
Yeah.
You know.
He's actually on my bucket list, believe it or not. Rod's
well, you know, people that know him, and they like him a lot. So
yeah, no, I heard that, you know, he's a very, the thing about him is that he is a very intelligent man, and a lot of people, I know that he has the persona and stuff, but they're, you know, I've heard that the guy is just incredible. When, you know, you can have,
I got to tell you, that to be able to write and direct a movie, you yeah. have to be very intelligent.
Yeah.
I mean, the directors that I know, like I know Richard Friedman, who did Darkwolf, he's very bright. Adam mm-hmm. Green's really smart. You know, it's just part of the deal. I mean.
Yeah. Yeah, they're thinking on a whole different level. Because they're, you know, yeah, I mean, they're thinking, they're forward. Yeah, I mean, it's just, like I said, he is on a bucket list. He is on one of, I would love to just have a dinner or something with him. And, you know, I know that's kind of weird of all the people.
No, it's not weird at all.
The people I've met and stuff. Rob's on me. He's the one that's on my list. And
well, I'll tell you a funny story is that when we were at the Paracon in Minnesota,
sure.
Somebody asked me a question. They said, you know, you must have a fascinating life being a stuntman and, you know, ghost hunter, which is kind of funny because Kane started as a stuntman and he's a ghost hunter, and they didn't ask him the question,
yeah.
You know. but I said, yeah, I said, you know, my life is different. I said, I played golf the other day. This just explains my life a little bit. I said, I played golf the other day, and one of the guys that I was playing with played the Gorn in Star Trek.
Okay.
Okay. I said, and as soon as I get to the 18th, there is George Wilbur, who played Michael Myers.
Michael, yeah.
So I stand there and I talk to him. I get in my car and my phone rings and it's R.A., the guy who plays Leatherface. So I chat with him on the way home, and as I come up, my phone's ringing. As I come in the door, I run over and I grab, and it's Kane, who played Jason. And I said, now, it's really cool because I'm probably the only person in the world who can say the last four people they talked to was the Gorn, Michael Myers, Leatherface, and Jason.
Jason.
Right? And they all go, yeah, 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 and they're clapping and stuff. I said, but here's my side of it. Where's Heather? Where's Bambi? Where's Barbie? All I got is serial killers and giant lizards.
Yeah. Yeah, why am I stuck with all the, like, the maniacs of Silver Screen? Yeah, I'm stuck.
You know,
with
one side it looks really cool, but when you look at it from the other side, it's like, oh man.
Yeah. Yeah. Hey, when these guys, I gotta ask, well, I mean, it's, you know, obviously, you know, when you're talking to Jason and stuff, I've always wondered, when you play those roles, those types of roles, do you really have to disconnect yourself from that? Because I can see where, how do you say this? I can see where people can get caught up in that. Yeah, caught up in that.
Yeah. Well, see, that doesn't work with Kane, because for Kane to play, you know, nasty serial killers, we have to get him to tamp his personality down a little bit.
Yeah.
You know, because in real life, he's even worse than those guys.
Oh, stop.
No, actually, that's another thing that's really funny. Kane is a member of Mensa, which a lot of people don't know, or he qualified for Mensa. I don't know if he ever actually went through the whole process.
Yeah.
So, I mean, he's hyper-intelligent. You know, it's funny, like Bill Moseley, who's also another, you know, fairly well-known horror actor. He's super. I think he graduated from Yale or Harvard or something. And I'll be sitting there at lunch or dinner with those two, and they'll be talking back and forth. And I'm like, I have no concept of what they're saying. I'm like listening to foreign language.
I just have this vision of Leatherface, like Leatherface and Jason talking quantum mechanics string theory.
Well, no, it wouldn't be Leatherface, because that's R.A. R.A. is a trained Shakespearean actor. He'd be more likely to say, forsooth, and how art thou, you know, you know, stuff like that.
That's funny. Manu, it's funny because Manu, a good, you know, he's a good friend of the show. he's doing The Circuit, which they're it's an anthology about it's a new movie that they're putting together called The Circuit, and it's an anthology about all of the conventions, like the Star Trek conventions and stuff. And it's hilarious. I had to put you guys in touch because I'm sure there could be some cross mix, because like he's going to have one of the stories is two of the Star Trek characters are going to the you know, convention, to the Comic-Con or whatever. And one of them is a secret agent. The other one, you know, is a werewolf or what, you know, and it's just this crazy stuff that they're doing just to kind of make fun and also celebrate, you know, the 20 something years of, or 30 plus years of these conventions that you guys go to. And it's just funny. Yeah, the stuff that
the conventions,
come up with.
You know, I've been to a few of them and I've been to a bunch of the Comic-Cons.
Yeah.
We've actually been signing autographs and stuff for different movies down there. And, you know, sure. I went down and hung around with Aaron and Nick while they were down there one time. But, yeah, those some of those things. I mean, have you ever been to one of the, like, San Diego Comic-Con?
I didn't go. No, to answer your question, no. I don't. You know, Comic-Con doesn't need another fat fanboy. There's enough there. They don't need another one. So I don't go. I should go, but I don't.
You should, because the whole experience, it's not so much what you're seeing, you know, yeah. I mean, there's celebrities there in the booth and everything else.
Sure.
But I mean, just the whole downtown is packed with people, you know, in cosplay costumes.
Yes.
And, you know, and then you go into this thing that's city blocks long and two stories high. And I mean, and everywhere you look, there's, you know, people walking around. I mean, it's such an atmosphere that, I mean, it's something everybody should go to at least once.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, it's just, it's amazing. The whole downtown is filled. It's you know, it's really a cool thing.
Yeah, we used to go to, like in the computers, I used to go to the old computer technology show in Las Vegas. And,
then was that Comdex?
You'd have Comdex. Well, what was crazy, there's a lot of people didn't know this. See, I'm gonna let the cat out of the bag. I'm telling some secrets here. So you'd have Comdex, which was the big computer show, and then right after that you had the adult entertainment show, which was in the same pavilion.
They were usually in the same building.
They were in the same building. Time. It was hilarious. So you had these multimillionaire geek guys who couldn't get a date if their life depended on it. And you know, we'd go to Comdex, and then of course you'd go to the adult entertainment award, you know, the adult. And life was good. As a computer guy,
life was good.
life was good. Yeah, don't feel sorry for the geeks. I mean, we got it. You know, we had it down pat. We had it down pat.
Well, let me put it this way: I really doubt if Bill Gates has a hard time getting a date.
No. There's a few stories. Yeah, I can. Well, I'm not going to attest to anything.
Don't let the cat out of the bag.
Yeah, I'm not going to tell, but yeah, no, it was most guys. Well, even Stephen Hawking is known for his attendance at certain adult nightclubs. Very well known. I mean, that's not unusual. Hey, the way I look at it, whatever works, right? Whatever works.
Yeah.
As long, you know, that's between you and whoever, you know, it's not for me to say either way, but yeah, it was fun. Yeah, but Bill, yeah, I'll just leave it at that.
Well, I'm looking here at my phone, and I've got like one thing of charge left.
We blew through a whole hour there, my friend. I just want to let you know that.
Well, we've blown through three whole hours.
Well, we've done three full hours. See, and you kind of laughed at me when I said four, because I can probably go another hour if we try. But no, I will be courteous, and I know it's getting late, and it is a Friday night for you. And so, but before we leave, is there anything you want to talk about? And how do people, I have a link to your website on our website, but how would people find out more about what you're doing and some of the projects? I know that you have a project. You go to Scotland quite a bit. I want to make sure that we talk about that.
I love Scotland. I'm going to go back there in June. Mm-hmm. I may be going to Paveglia Island in Italy too. That's we're trying to hook that up. That's the one that terrifies everybody. Naturally, I want to go there. Years ago, you know, I have an online magazine. It's HGH, which stands for Hollywood Ghost Hunters, mag.com. And in that thing, I made a bet with the people in Scotland. You know, I said, look, if you've got a castle or someplace that is supposed to be extraordinarily haunted, if you let me go in there with one cop and we'll go all the way through the place and make sure nobody else is in there, lock me in, and if I try to get out before the next morning, I'll give you $1,000 in cash. And nobody took me up on my offer. So
there you go.
I'm kind of hoping that somebody will do it this time.
I'm telling you, I'm looking. I have a friend over there doing some digs and stuff, and I've heard some things. So, but we'll see what we can do. And so are you guys doing anything on TV these days? Do you have any shows coming up?
Well, we keep getting people trying to get us a show all the time. They keep coming to us. But one of the problems is, you know, Kane makes a lot of money doing movies.
Yeah.
You know, to tell him, say, okay, we're going to pay you this amount of money. And he goes, really?
Yeah. So he's like, do a TV show or that and stuff.
No, Kane would be very, very happy to do one. You know, I mean, we've actually gone and sat down and, you know, talked to a bunch of people. Matter of fact, one of the biggest ovations I've ever gotten at a Paracon, somebody asked us that question, are you guys going to have a TV show? And I said, well, here's one of the things. I said, I got contacted by a very well-known production company. I said, and I went over and they wanted to sign us. And I asked, and he asked me, you know, he said, well, let me ask you this. If it starts getting a little slow, you know, if nothing's happening on the hunt, is there anything we can do? And I said, well, let me ask you this. Are you suggesting that we fake things? And he goes, well, you know, we got to make sure things are going along. And I just stood up, stuck my hand out. I said, been nice talking to you, and walked out.
Yeah.
You know, so, but that got the biggest ovation at the Paracon, you know.
Yeah.
It's like, no, we're not going to do that. You know, all I've got to my name, you know, I'm not a rich guy, particularly handsome, not overly smart, but nobody's going to say that I lied to him or, you know, didn't have integrity. That's the only two things I can control.
Yeah. And you know, and that's what, like I said, when I see all these ghost shows coming out and these things, you know, it's like, you know, my concern is how much of that stuff is staged. And it's always that's always been a concern, to get ratings, because there's only so many pictures of meters you can show and stuff like that.
Yeah. Well, one of the things that I think sometimes has happened, and I know it didn't happen on Ghost Adventures, because Kane and I and RA, when we were on it, we watched like hawks, because like I said, our reputation is very important to us.
Sure.
And, you know, the Ghost Adventures guys were 100% above board. Good. You know, nothing, you know, about that. But I do know, just from a couple of producers that I have talked to, that they had worked, you know, on some of the ghost shows, and they said it's not beyond, you know, something that the producers might do something that the people don't know about.
Yeah. Oh, you mean after the fact in post-production or something like that?
No, like throw something down the hallway, you know.
See,
you know, and that, things like that.
See, and that's why I want to do my show the way that, I want to do my thing, because I want to make sure no one's in the building and it's just me
That's why I wanted to be the only one in the building and have a cop go through there and make sure there wasn't.
Sure.
Because if I got any things like an EVP of somebody way off in the distance running or something, they can't say, well, because it could have been somebody in there. No, it couldn't have been, because the cop just checked the whole building and locked me in. There's nobody else in here.
Yeah, there's no one.
You know?
But, yeah, I remember there was one, I guess, in Ghost Hunters where they found the false door. And, someone pulled the car. I remember watching that episode where someone.
That was the Queen Mary.
The Queen Mary, exactly. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And they went off on them. They and rightfully so, they did. And then I saw the other Zach, the one Zach Halloween special where they were doing with a guy, and he had it, you know, supposedly the recorder was ripped out of the guy's hand, but you can clearly see the guy through it, you know. And Zach went off on him as well. Said, look, you know, you're done.
Well, Zach, you know, has, you know, he's got a lot of integrity.
Yeah.
You know, he realizes that, you know, that's his show.
Yeah.
Well, you know, and everything on there reflects him. Yeah. So, I mean, he's, you know, Zach, what a lot of people don't understand is a very intelligent guy. When I interviewed him, he was the first person I interviewed for the magazine.
Sure.
And I sent him one of the things when I interview people, I always let them read it before I put it up. So I sent it to him, and it was like, I don't know, 5 pages long. And it couldn't have been, you know, 10 minutes maybe. He sent it back with changes that he'd gone through, and they were all good changes, you know?
Yeah.
So, I mean, the fact that he read it that fast, had his changes done, and had it back to me that quick.
Yeah.
You know, I was like, this guy's got a lot on the ball.
Yeah.
You know?
The only thing I laugh about with Zach is that he always said, is it Aaron? Yeah, Aaron.
Yeah.
You know, which Aaron, I watched the show not till Aaron's starting to, you know, Aaron's lost a lot of weight, but it's funny. He always sends Aaron in there. Yeah, Aaron, why don't you go in this room and hang out for a few hours and then we'll come and get you. And it's like,
Aaron's like the designated victim.
Yeah, poor Aaron. That guy. I mean, yeah, it is funny. I watched that show and it's hilarious. I've seen shirts where the people printed up shirts to that effect that, hey, Aaron, you know, Aaron's like Mikey. He's like Mikey. You know, Mikey will taste anything.
Aaron is such a cool guy, too. All those guys are cool.
Yeah.
I mean, Nick Groff, he's not with them anymore. He's got his own shows, but he's really cool. He's a friend of mine.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. No, I like I said, so in parting and stuff, so what shows, if we want to watch good quality ghost hunting shows, you know, obviously Zach's show, you would highly recommend. What are some other ones?
That would be the one that I would recommend if you had to watch one.
Okay.
There's another one that I saw was, and it was Nick's show, was called The Ghosts of Shepherdstown, which was really pretty interesting how they actually had an entire town where things were happening.
Wow. Okay.
And that, I think you could see that on other things.
They
also have, you know, they have some other ones now, like, Paranormal Lockdown. That's Nick's new show. That's pretty interesting. And there's another one, Kindred Spirits, which is actually on, comes on right now.
Mm. Yeah, Kindred.
On Destination America.
On Destination America, yep. It's actually, I know, I watched that one, and then, yeah, I mean, it's just like I said, you got to watch for the, you know, the entertainment and see, you know, what is true. See, I'm still waiting, though, for the true science, like the true science where, you know, and we talked about this, like one of the things I want to do with the EEG and the EKG and having the video cameras set up, the night vision cameras, but also set up the Gauss meters throughout, and so we can actually track an entity moving through a hallway or something, and then display that in 3D, and you know, like true, where scientists will go. Yeah, we might not agree with their conclusions, but their methods were scientific in nature.
Yeah, and the one thing wrong with that, and it's not wrong, but it's going to be hard to do, is ghosts don't play on command.
Yes.
You know, so it's real hard to do that. One thing that I like to do when I'm by myself, and it hasn't happened yet, you know, I'll take 3 K2 meters and stand them on edge.
Yeah.
Down a hallway, like the one you're seeing, you know, where you saw that stuff. I didn't do it there. I should have. And set them, you know, like 10 feet apart, you know, and then stand down at the end of the hallway and say, if there's anything down here, come on down towards me.
Yeah.
And I want to see number 3 light up, then number 2 light up, then number 1 light up.
Because
it's, I think that would be very compelling evidence.
Well, that was one of the things that, you know, we're working on right now. And it's in my little lab.
Stuff. Yeah, you told me about that earlier today. That was kind of fascinating.
Yeah, where we take a gauze
and stuff.
Yeah, it's actually portable, and that's the thing is that, you know, with a gauze meter with multiple inputs on this gauze meter. So what we do is we string copper wire down, and then, you know, it's attached to the ceiling, and then it strings down, and then what happens is that you can each input has its own, so you can actually, if something, and literally if you have a human being walk by it, it will pick up that human walking by that, and you can actually track. It's the same technology some security systems are built on, without getting into too much trouble and disclosure, but
there's a bunch of new technologies out there. There's one that I saw. It's actually it looks like a ship's wheel. You know, it's mm-hmm. circular and it's got tubes sticking out at, you know, different points. And the tubes are different colors.
Yeah.
And what it is, it's all EMF. But if you were to set it down in the middle of a room and something walked by it, the lights would light up 1, 2, 3 as it went by. So you could actually be able to chart
yeah.
the path of whatever was walking by it.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes when you've got a K2 meter in your hand, it's going off and going off. You don't know if it's funny on the side of you, behind you.
Yeah, you don't know the direction exactly. And that would be nice to know the actual direction in which it's at and stuff. So, look, I got some technology. We'll have to get together because I am very intrigued. And, you know, I can be the fat man of your group. I'm not soliciting.
That's my job.
You can tell Kane. You can tell Kane, say, look, man, you're skinny now.
So, well, we actually have one guy in our group that at one time was 400. So.
Yeah. See, I still got him beat. I'm a big boy. I'm a big guy. And
well, it sounds like it.
Yeah.
No, if you're over 350, I mean, in 6'5", that's, you know.
Yeah, I'm six. Well, exactly, I'm 6'5", about 6'6".
Size.
Yeah, no, I'm a big man. So it's it's not something to be proud of, but I am, and it's amazing I'm still walking on this earth and still functioning. But we'll get there. Hopefully, we'll in a few years we'll get down. That was that's my goal for this year.
You want to know my secret to weight loss?
What's that?
Take the batteries out of your remote for your TV.
You know what? I'll tell you one thing. We turned off all of TV in this house, in the Norton home. Now, we do have like Prime or something like that, where if there's a movie or something that Sandy and I want to sit and watch together, there is only one show that Sandy and I watch together, and that's Heartland, and it's a Canadian broadcast show. It's out of Canada. And we've watched that for a year, but that's the only real shows where we sit down and say, we got to watch. Other than that, no, we unplugged, last month, and I can tell you my life and, it's just tremendous difference. I can tell. Yeah. We unplugged.
Well, that wouldn't be good for me because I'm single. And if I didn't have a television, I would just be sitting here in the dark.
That's it. See, I want to do the... And that's not good. That's not good. No,
I would get a little lonely after a while, sit here alone.
Yeah. I was watching that movie with, and I know you got to go before you run out of battery, but I was watching that movie Central Intelligence. I love what that scene where The Rock, where he comes out and he's all like buff, you know, he starts out fat and stuff and he's like, well, how'd you do it? He goes, well, I worked 6 hours a day or 6 hours a day in a gym for the last 29 years.
It's funny is I used to hear girls because I go to Gold's Gym.
Yeah.
And I'd hear girls say to their trainer, well, I don't want to look like Arnold Schwarzenegger. It's like, well, yeah, he worked out every day lifting, 400 pounds, for the last 30 years and was,
And he did it twice.
A couple of supplements that you can't buy over the counter.
Yeah, they're illegal. Yeah. And we're not saying anything if people already don't know. And he did it twice a day. That was the thing. He had a morning routine and an afternoon routine.
Yep.
Yeah. Well, that, and I know that.
And it's not ratting him out about the steroids.
No.
He ratted himself out.
That's what I'm saying is that, don't think that we just told the secret. And well, see, that was my problem. I'm a lifter. I was one of those guys. Give me the biggest weights you can give me and I'll lift them. And that was, and the problem is when you do that to your body, you get into that and then you stop doing it. It shows. And that's that's like a lot of these pro athletes, these pro football players. That's a big issue right now for a lot of the linemen. They get huge.
They get used to, burning off 8 billion calories a day and eating, 8 billion. And then as soon as they, become,
civilians,
where they're not playing anymore.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden they're taking in 6,000 calories a day more than they're burning.
Yep.
When they used to burn it off.
Yep. 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 So that's,
you go from 250 to 350 in about an hour and a half.
Yeah. No. I know the secrets. I'm working. I'll get back down. My goal is to get back down to about 285 would be my,
I want to get down to about 230 again.
Hmm. Yeah. See, I don't know if I could do 230.
I'm at that point where my knees hurt, my feet hurt, my hair hurts.
I'm with you, brother.
You know, I have not treated my body well. You know, I've had 6 knee operations, broken my legs twice, broken my ankles 3 times. You know, broken every finger except for 1 thumb, broken my nose 4 times. You know.
I can see a guy like you. See, I don't want to get in that thing where I have to have knee surgery. I haven't, I've been knock on cheap wood. I've at my size, you would think that I would have I've not been there, and that's what I'm trying to avoid. And a good friend of mine who's a nurse, she's like, Jeff, she goes, you're worried about having a heart attack. She goes, that's going to, kill you instantly. She goes, at your size. And so if you have a heart attack, you're dead. So don't worry about that. It's all the other stuff you got to worry about, the diabetes, and which I don't have or anything. She goes, the fact when they start cutting off body parts because you were, too lazy to do what you needed to do. And that was the eye opener for me when she said that, because I always thought.
Yeah, well, that's a pretty good incentive program.
Yeah. I always thought, well, okay, I'm going to die of the heart attack. Boom, be done. Okay, I'm done. Right? She's like, no. What's going to happen? Is it you're probably, it's going to be the other stuff, the diabetes, the losing of toes, the losing of legs, and all that. She goes, that's what you got to be worried about. So like in about 2 years, I'm on the road. I'm doing everything. We got rid of the TV, and the exercising, got a pool in the backyard with, exercising jets and all that stuff. So we're getting there. And then,
I don't know if you know this or not, but I am the best trainer of women in the world.
Oh, really?
What's that? Here's my whole program. I only take really hot women to train.
Yeah.
And I'll take them out to a place, and I'll find a place that's a mile long.
Sure.
And I'll put them out 100 yards ahead of me. And I said, okay, here's what we're doing today. When I say go, you run to that end of that thing as fast as you can, because if I catch you, I get to have my way with you.
Oh, there you go.
And it's and it's been a long time for me, so I'm going to really run fast.
Yeah.
Ready? Go.
There you go. That's it. See, yeah.
Never caught one yet. Dang
see,
it.
See, my thing is that I'm motivated to lose the weight, because if I ever go out with you guys, I don't want to be I don't want to be the sacrificial guy, because he can't run faster than you guys. I would be. I'll be the bear bait.
We run like sloths, so.
Well, no, but
you could probably outrun half of us anyway.
Yeah, be bear bait. It was funny. I had a real good friend. He said he gave me a news article where a guy kills or defends himself from a bear with a .22, and you're like, there's no way a guy can defend himself with a bear with a. Well, you read the story. It's like a guy's out walking with his wife. And a bear attacks him.
22 for a bear.
He shoots his wife in the knee and runs off.
And well, that would do it, yeah.
That's how he avoided the bear. I was like, that's sick, but I don't want to be that guy for you guys. So I got to lose the weight.
When we were doing a movie called Deep Star 6, we were off Catalina Island, and me and this girl, Maria, were in this rubber life raft. And off to the side, there's a helicopter, filming from above, and we've got a walkie-talkie hidden in the side of the raft. And Kane is off in the rescue boat off to the side.
Yeah.
And we're sitting there, and I see this big fin pop out of the water. And it's going parallel to us. It's not like coming towards us. And I'm like, oh, boy. So I don't say anything, and I'm still paddling like we're supposed to do. And I see it again. And then I hear the walkie-talkie go off, and it goes, Kane, don't let the stunt people go in the water. Right? And Maria says, what's that? I said, Maria, I don't want to scare you, but there's a very big shark right over there. Right? And she goes, oh. And I said, got to ask you a question, Maria. She goes, what? I said, how fast can you swim? And she goes, don't be silly. You can't outswim a shark. I said, I know. I just have to outswim you.
I just got
to
outswim you. That's right. That's it. Right. That's funny.
And I think she said something along the lines like, I'm not afraid. And I said, why? She goes, it's a man eater. I'm a girl. Bless her heart. She was a scrappy girl.
See, that's funny. That is so funny, but oh wow, what a way to end it and stuff, man. Rick, I appreciate you coming on the show and spending time with us. I thoroughly enjoyed it, and I know our listeners did too, and everything. And we'll direct people out to your website, and hopefully we'll get someone in Scotland to take you up on that deal.
It'd be a good article for somebody.
Absolutely, absolutely. I'm going to put you in my Rolodex. As one of the guys, when I finally get up to Ohio and hit the prisons and stuff, I'll definitely be contacting you and say, all right, what should this idiot do besides not do it?
Oh, you got to do it.
Yeah, I got to do it. No, I think it
you
would
gotta
be.
You got to do it.
It's for science. I'm literally going to do it for science. I mean, no one's ever done a study where they've hooked themselves up to EEGs. And you can actually see the fit. No, we've looked for it. No one's done it because, well, the technology is pretty, you're talking medical stuff and so it's not something that you can just easily do. And so, yeah, it's going to be interesting because I have my theories and I want to prove them out and stuff.
When you have hard scientific fact, I mean, that's something good. Just like what Stanton said, do you believe this with no empirical evidence?
Yeah.
And they said, you believe in UFOs.
Yeah. This is true. So, this is true. All right, Rick, take care, my friend. Be well, be safe, and I will definitely be in touch with you. All right.
Well, thanks for having me. No problem.
Yep. Take care. Bye now. There you go, Rick McCallum, joining us all the way from L.A. What a, incredible stuff, man. I love the stories, I've always said what I enjoy about this show and the type of show that we do here at the Midnight Ocean is the fact that it's very it's conversational. And you hear how things develop, how people go from point A to point B to point C and stuff and the stories and the things and the tribulations and, things that people go through. It's amazing. It's amazing. I'm going to take a quick break. I think we're going to reset here. Like I said, we're going to reset. We'll take about a 6 minute break. And then when we get back, we'll open the phone lines up. If anybody wants to call in, we'll open them up for a few minutes. And it is Friday, so I want to let you guys get back, get ready for the weekend. But I also want to give you guys opportunity to give us a call. And that number is going to be 352-388-3900. Don't call it now. It's not set up yet. Take the break. But when we come back from break, you can give us a call at area code 352-388-3900. Love to hear from you. As we continue on our night here at the Midnight Ocean Radio Show and Podcast. Andrew, this is the Midnight Ocean Radio Show and a podcast as we cruise on into the evening and into the weekend. I just want to say thank you, everybody, for participating, all you guys out there in the chat room. I appreciate all your well wishes, all your... Don't be concerned for us. Be concerned. It's okay. It's okay. I appreciate the fact that you guys are concerned about our well-being as we delve into this world of paranormal, and I appreciate it. Don't think that I do not. But we're in good hands. I know who protects me. Got that down. So if you want to give me a call, the phone lines are open, 352-388-3900. That's area code 352-388-3900. Love to hear from you right before we go into the weekend. I hope you guys have plans for the weekend. I really do. I hope you have something lined up other than sitting around and watching the, as my grandparents used to say, the boob tube, the idiot box. And stuff. Talk about the weekend. I won't be watching the box, but I'll be listening to the internet. As for those that don't know, is that Mercedes-Benz Nico Rosberg is driving for the championship this year. Go Nico. I am a huge fan of Formula One and everything. And so go Nico, go Nico. Hopefully maybe he can wrap it up this weekend in Brazil. And, if he finishes a third or above, or not in Brazil, but in Bahrain, if he finishes third or above, he has won the champions, first championship. Wish him the best of luck. So if you guys want to give us a call, 352-388-3900. Love to hear from you. Open topics. You guys can talk. Tell me your scariest ghost story that you've got. If you have one, if you don't want to talk on the phone, you can always put it in the chat room. Love to hear from you there. So we'll keep the lines open for a few minutes. And if we have no takers, no biters or anything like that, we will then call it a night, let you guys get on with your weekend. Like I said, please, please have things planned. I know a lot of you guys are getting ready for the Thanksgiving holiday. And Bubba Kitty, I want to tell you how not to bring demons home with you. Noted, yeah. Yeah, I will say the best thing to do, how do I say this? I'm not going to take my own medicine because this is the profession that I've chosen. The best way to do it is don't get involved. don't do it. Not worry about it. Yeah, I mean, that's the best thing. Is don't, you know, leave it up to the pros, leave it up to those and people that have, like I said, I have a Rolodex. I have a list of people that I can call instantly, as I did last week, and that were more that could help me instantly. And it's very important that you do that and everything that you have those lists. But the best way to do it is just avoid it, right? Do the right thing. Live a good life. Do your prayers. But if you feel that you are under oppression or something of that nature, seek out professional advice. You know, shoot me an email. The best way to get in touch with me, and I'll put this up here so that you guys have it, because I will always be there to help you. There it is, listener.themidnightocean@gmail.com. That is the best way to... If you need to speak with anybody, shoot me an email. I will get back with you as soon as possible and do what I can do to help you if you're ever caught up in that situation. But please, please, feel free to give me a call too at 352-388-3900. Love to hear from you. If you have a story, if something is bugging you, I am here. I'm here for you. Oh, wow. What a night. What a weekend. I hope you guys have plans. Well, since I have no takers on the phone line, and I am just about as anxious as you are to get on with the rest of the evening. I just want to say thank you. God bless you guys. Thanks for joining. I hope you guys have a great weekend. I mean, remember to do something with someone you love, if you don't have anybody close, any friends, any family, anything like that, you know, go out and visit nature. Get out and visit nature. See what God has given you, the abundance of life. I mean, I've done this exercise and it's amazing. Grab a leaf or a piece of grass and just stare at it for hours. It is amazing the world that he has created for us to enjoy and everything. Well, once again, I just want to say thank you. God bless you guys. I will be back on Monday. Now, the schedule for next week is going to be kind of tricky. I don't know what we're going to do, being that it is the holidays and everything. And I plan on spending those holidays with my loved ones, my family. So we're probably not going to do a show, obviously, on Thanksgiving. There's going to be, I can already tell you, no show on Thanksgiving. And more than likely the Wednesday before, that we're kind of holding off on guests and everything for next week. Just for that reason. Because we want to do it. And I might just say the whole week of next week is just going to be one big vacation. We'll probably do that for Thanksgiving. And then again, we will do it for Christmas week as well. Just one big vacation for that and stuff. Got to take a vacation, guys. Can't continually do this without getting burned out. You're looking at 4 hours a night. And then at the first year, we're going to be going to 5 hours, which is another story. So be well, take care of yourself. And as my good friend Ed Roman would say, make sure if you're going to be anything, be love. Good night.
Midnight Ocean with Jeff Norton on the Paranormal State Radio Network.